does that thing with his head. It's always yes.
He is a bobblehead, and he doesn't talk.
Next game day, call the right play to find your beach. Call the Gruden hotline.
No, he scored a touchdown and a two-point conversion this season early in the year versus Syracuse. But also, guys, he plays defense, but he is the second leading rusher on this Pitt team. The interesting touch today is how many touches will he get on offense to really have an impact on the game?
DJ Duke will touch the ball first as Pitt won the toss and elected to defer. There are a couple of flags out after the 20-yard return by Sean Wilson. 73 degrees at game time. Very light breezes, 45% humidity. David Epperle is our referee.
Unsportsmanlike conduct on the receiving team, forming the illegal wedge on the kickoff. Half a dozen, two to go. First down.
Dave Archer, time for the Food Line Impact Players, and we start with Duke.
Yeah, TJ Ramming, big-time player on the outside, leads the team in receptions. They'll need to get number three the ball as much as they can. And Copenhaver, the tight end, is a guy that has been big for them in the red zone. Three touchdown receptions, that leads the team as well.
The Blue Devils this season are 4-3, 1-3 in conference play, and 3-2 at home. There's the starting quarterback, Daniel Jones, 6'5". 215 pounds and a sophomore from Charlotte, North Carolina, and Charlotte Latin High School. He'll start from the shotgun. Wilson taken down short of the 15-yard line for Sean Wilson, the senior, also from Charlotte. Whitehead had the tackle after a 6-yard gain.
Food Line Impact players for Pitt defensively. Sean Adowu, excellent linebacker, sideline to sideline guy, leads him in tackles. And Avante Maddox, outstanding corner on the outside, 7 career interceptions. He's a guy that can really run. You'll see him on offense as well today.
Maddox does have one interception this season. That is Wilson, close to the marker, but maybe just a little bit short, 3 yards on the rush.
Talked about right off the top, get your best players the football. Started off with Wilson carrying the football in this run game. And this is a Duke team that has been kind of pass-oriented over the years under David Cutcliffe. Not this year. This is a team that's got two big-time backs.
Eighth in the conference and third down conversions, 39% for the Blue Devils. This is third and short. Wilson, he's got enough, for the chains are going to move after a 2-yard gain from Sean Wilson.
Yeah, nice statement being set here by Duke up front. Come off the ball, 3 consecutive run plays here, Tom, trying to establish themselves physically a little bit in this game. This is going to be these are two teams that pride themselves on the physicality on both sides of the ball along the front.
David Cutcliffe is the 10th year head coach for the Blue Devils, 5th in the conference in rushing. 190 yards per game on the ground. That's where they'll go again with Wilson. A little change of direction and up to the 23-yard line.
Tom, you talk about these two backs. Sean Wilson, who's the senior, he's a guy that has a little bit more shake to him. You saw him cut back there and find that little hole. When Britton Brown, the freshman, comes in, a little bit bigger body, still has the ability to run it. You see there 190 yards a game. Tom just talked about 5th in the ACC in rushing. But Brown, a little bit bigger back, a little bit more power.
Wilson is the team's leading rusher. Gets another chance. Trying to turn that corner, and he can't do it. It's only a yard. There's DeMar Hamlin. Came up to stop him.
Well, it's a good play by Hamlin, too. This is a play that's strung out defensively. Now you're hoping for somebody to come out of secondary and finish him off, and Hamlin gets that done, pushes him out of bounds. Virtually no gain. Now third and medium.
5 receiver set for Duke. Another third down. This third and 5. From their own 24-yard line for the Blue Devils. Jones lets it fly. Actually, Pittsburgh had a chance to pick that one off with Hamlin.
Yeah, I didn't like the matchup either. Tried to find Copenhaver in the slot. Pretty tight coverage, and Jones a little bit late with the ball coming out, and you got zone safeties back there. Excellent opportunity for Hamlin to come up with a pick there. Felt like maybe he got held up a little bit as he was on the out route. Now, this kid right here is a big-timer, Tom. We talk about Henderson. Last time we saw him was at Georgia Tech. He had an 80-yarder for a touchdown.
Austin Parker, the punt to Henderson. Backtracks to the 30. Gets away from the first two men. And then is pulled down at the 35-yard line. 46 yards on the punt. It's a 5-yard return. Our Carolina Ford keys to the game with Dave Archer. And Dave, you've got formulas to success for these teams today.
Yeah, for Duke, the formula, or I'm sorry, for Pitt, the formula is Q squared, and that's Quadre Henderson and Quadre Olson. Need to get both those guys going. They're big time players. Pitt needs some help from those two on the offensive side of the ball. And for Duke, a little bit more complicated. Well, E versus equals MC squared. That's energy and effort equals the mass of their defensive front up front outstanding and the Cheetah Coalition in the back end.
You don't have to be Einstein to figure out that both of these teams are trying to stop losing streaks this afternoon. Pittsburgh, first chance on offense. It's Darrin Hall up to the 40-yard line. 5 yards for Hall. Time for the Food Lion Impact players. And here come the Panthers, Dave.
Well, Jimmy Morrissey's been outstanding as the redshirt freshman at center. Done a nice job. Started all 7 games for this season. And Quadre Olison. Talked about Henderson, the returner in the opening. Olison is the big back. Number 37. He'll change in and out at the running back position with Hall. Hall in there right now. But Olison is the big back. Had 1,100 yards 2 years ago.
Danucci keeps this one. Tried to bounce it outside, but was taken down at the 42 or 3-yard line. 3 yards after the tackle by Jordan Hayes for Duke.
Now, this is what Danucci's going to bring to the table that they didn't have potentially with Max Brown, more of a pocket passer. Danucci will run the zone read we saw there. Excellent open field tackle by Hayes, part of that Cheetah Coalition. That's what they call themselves in the secondary here at Duke. But Danucci is operative. His ability to run the football makes him more of a threat in these situations, Tom, than maybe anywhere else because his ability to pull it down and take off.
Third and short. Pittsburgh just 12th in the conference in third down situations. They're going to get this one up near midfield. It's Darrin Hall.
They used that kind of a combination of backs, and Hall's going to hit this one straight in. Came in averaging about 3.5 yards a carry. Missed tackle right at the start. Good high knees by Hall to pick up the first down. Food Lion Impact players defensively for Duke. It's that big fella up front. Ramsey, he's the leader on the defensive front. It's a good defensive front as well. And their linebackers can run and hit. They're led by Joe Giles Harris.
Nice conversation with Joe Giles Harris yesterday, the leading tackler for the Blue Devils. Gregarious young man, but his attitude changes once he gets between the white lines, Dave.
Well, and here's Joe Giles Harris right here. Tom playing in that extended area that a linebacker off the extend to. Number 44 reaches in with the right hand and bats it out. Had a little help from Alonzo Saxon, the safety. But that kid right there, he had a chance to do a game a couple of weeks ago against Virginia, and he's still making tackles in that game. Shaka, guys all over the field.
Yeah, you talk about Joe Giles. I had a chance to talk to him earlier this week, and he said we kind of treat Pitt like a triple option offense in the way that we watch him and have to be really good with our eyes and continue to do your job. He said everybody has to do their job, especially playing against offense like this, what we've seen early with the jet sweeps and all the eye candy they have to deal with in front of them.
Yeah, this is a team that wants to be physical, much like Duke wants to be today as far as running the football. We talked about that Virginia game. There he is, 15 tackles. He had 3.5 of those for loss. And Chuck, you kind of wonder when you see Jordan Whitehead, when Quadre Henderson touches the football.
Yeah, because Jordan Whitehead, like I talked about in the open, is a dynamic player, but he's one of those guys who is standing over on the offensive side right now. He's not with the defensive guys. He's looking for an opportunity, but they definitely have to find a way to get the ball to Quadre Henderson.
Third and 5, Shock, for the Panthers. This is Hall, dragged down. Ben Humphreys wrapped him up well short of the marker. Had to get to the 42, and he only got 2 yards on the play.
Tom, these two linebackers, Giles Harris, who we've already mentioned, and Ben Humphreys are the best of friends. In fact, they've got a little friendly competition. Who's going to make the most tackles today? Well, I guess you're going to have to get – Ben's not going to like the fact that Joe Giles came in there and Giles Harris came in and got him an assist on his tackle, but those two guys can really fly sideline to sideline.
Ryan Winslow, the senior punter, kicking to T.J. Ramming, standing at his 10-yard line. Winslow able to get that one away. Ramming looking for the fair catch, and he makes it at the 7. Almost 5 seconds of hang time on a 39-yard punt. There is no return. Always a great tailgate in Durham. Grab some ribs here. Duke in Pittsburgh, the ACC Network. Game of the week.
Founded in 1787.
With our eyes on the stars.
The Panther.
Traditions.
The Cathedral of Learning.
Olympic gold.
Curing polio.
National champions.
Pioneers in Transplants. Rhodes Scholars.
The Oakland Zoo.
And that's just our first 230 years. Hail to Pitt.
The perfect time to buy QLED. Save now at Samsung.com.
ACC football is brought to you by Mellow Mushroom, Out of This World Pizza. By Geico, saving people money for over 75 years. By your local Chevy dealers. By Dish. And by Haviland Motor Oil, official motor oil of the ACC. Keep going.
The Blue Devils and head coach David Cutcliffe making their way over to Wallace Wade Stadium. 63-year-old David Cutcliffe from Birmingham, Alabama.
You can't quantify what he's meant to this university in his 10 years.
That's behind the intended receiver, T.J. Ramming.
Yeah, when you want to, if you're struggling a little bit as a quarterback or maybe as an offense, these are the kind of things Coach Cutcliffe's talking about, that it's an offensive thing, not just a quarterback thing. This is a ball that you have to catch. A little behind Ramming, but he's got to make that catch. He backed up here offensively, make that catch on first down, and it puts you out near the 20-yard line. Instead, you're back inside your own 10.
Daniel Jones comes in, completing 56% of his passes. He's misfired on his two attempts so far. That one knocked down at the line by the Panthers.
Yeah, it looked like Rashad Weaver, the freshman, elevated and batted that ball down, Tom. These short throws, linemen are taught to, you know, get your hands near. You're not going to get pass rush on these quick throws, and a good job by Weaver to get the hand in the air. 6'5", that ball's going to be elevated pretty good. From Daniel Jones. Good job by Weaver to get a paw on it.
Quickly now, third down for the Blue Devils. 9 minutes to go in our first quarter. Jones wants to throw from his own end zone. And this pass in between a couple of defenders to Daniel Helm. And it's good enough for a first down out near the Duke 20. They got 13 on the connection.
Boy, what a nice feel for Helm. His 10th catch on the year. He's going to feel the zone in between the two Pitt defenders. Excellent job of getting the ball out on time by Jones. Third and long, excellent completion in a big moment deep in your own territory.
Big target, 6'4", 245-pound junior Daniel Helm with the grab and a fresh set of downs. Jones still has it. Pass is knocked away at the 25-yard line, intended for Chris Taylor, as we go back to Charlotte and Katie with them.
Let's go to Tallahassee. Louisville on the board first, but here comes Florida State.
Like to see James Blackman be. Continues to play well, game by game, finding Ryan Izzo, tight end, for a 7-yard touchdown right there. Like to see the nose keep that going.
Tie game, 7-7 in the first.
Louisville had a 43-point win between the teams last year. It's tied up as Katie mentioned. Daniel Jones taken down by Whitehead and Hamlin for 6 yards, Dave.
Well, Florida State was here a week ago, Tom, and really a hard-fought battle against this Duke team. 17-10, they were able to prevail, and Duke really felt like they had an opportunity to win it. But we talked about Daniel Jones' versatility. Big kid, 6'5", about 220. But he has the ability to run the football. Nice job there on the zone read. Now you got a third and four situation.
Jones threw for 204 yards in that loss, as Dave mentioned, against Florida State. Now he's got to scramble and get out of that pocket. Coming to the near side. Throws it up to the 35-yard line. And they've got it there. Catch.
Well, Chris Taylor worked down the sideline here, Tom. Whenever you get a scramble situation, you got to respond as a receiver. A lot of times if you're short, go deep. If you're deep, come back to the quarterback. And Taylor comes back along the sideline. Now, did he stay in bounds? And you almost wonder, did Daniel Jones step out of bounds before he threw it?
Illegal touching on the offense. The receiver went out on his own, came back in, was first to touch. The ball will be loss of down at the previous spot, fourth down.
So Chris Taylor had gone out of bounds, heard the description, on his own, and then returned. Had he been forced out, he could come back in, establish himself in bounds, and caught the football. But a good job of working back. Now, it didn't work out for him, penalty because he'd gone out of bounds, but that's what you want to do, respond as a receiver, come back and help your quarterback. Just didn't work out this time. And now you've got to deal with this guy, Quadri Henderson.
Yeah, he had a 65-yard punt return in the game between the teams a season ago in Pittsburgh, 56-14. Pitt won
it. Two career punt return touchdowns. Four career kickoff return touchdowns.
He'll come up to try to meet this one at the 38. He can't get there, and it takes a Duke roll. Down to the 21-yard line. It is a 52-yard punt from the sophomore Austin Parker. When we come back, the Panthers on offense from Durham.
NHL.tv, the way to watch live hockey.
Founded in 1787.
With our eyes on the stars.
The Panther.
Traditions.
The Cathedral of Learning.
Olympic gold. Curing polio.
National champions.
Pioneers in transplants. Rhodes Scholars.
The Oakland Zoo.
And that's just our first 230 years. Hail to Pitt.
First little doggy.
Leaving a career to follow a calling takes courage.
Second little doggy had great big spots, and he's got a new pair of shoes.
See how a personalized financial strategy and access to J.P. Morgan investment expertise can help you.
Watching ACC football presented by Mellow Mushroom. Back in Durham, North Carolina, Pitt football royalty, Darrell Revis.
The island is here. How about that? Eight career interceptions as a Pitt Panther. He took two of those back for touchdowns. Also had, I believe, two or three punt return touchdowns as a Pitt Panther. 29 career interceptions as an NFL corner. It truly was the island if you're a receiver destined to go against Darrell Revis.
Won a Super Bowl ring in the NFL with the Patriots. And here's Darrin Hall breaking free into new territory. Dashing for the end zone, and Hall scores. The Panthers pop the big play.
And we talked about little eye candy type things that potentially could take your eyes off of the deal. Here's Quadri Henderson here. He's going to come across in motion, and it will affect the defense. Little blitz by Humphreys. He blitzes right out of the play, and then Hall, excellent speed. Once he splits it, good job up front to sort out the Ben Humphreys blitz, and Hall puts it in the end zone. You know, Tom, this Duke defense was marred by four plays a year ago that were over 50 yards.
Second TD run of the season for Hall.
7 minutes and 23 seconds remaining in the first period.
Darrin Hall busts through the middle, and Pitt scratches first. This will be a battle. We'll be back after a word for your local ACC net station.
Financial planning works a lot like GPS. It's a roadmap for your money, helping you balance the life you want now and later. It can help you reach your goals, like the retirement of your dreams or a family vacation. Working with a Northwestern Mutual financial advisor means that you get a financial plan tailored to your life, helping you prioritize and reach your goals one by one. Life has many twists and turns. Planning with Northwestern Mutual can help you stay on track and make the most of your money today and tomorrow.
We drove all the way to North Carolina for two things: to play Duke and for Bojangles' famous chicken and biscuits.
It's bow time!
It's bow time at Bojangles. Grab a big bowl box, feed the whole group with Bojangles chicken, biscuits, fixins, and tea. Bojangles and Dr. Pepper giving you a chance to win a VIP trip for two to the 2017 Dr. Pepper ACC Football Championship. Enter at theacc.com/BOVIP. Sean Wilson on the return for Duke. Hits the roadblock at the 20. 17 yards on the return from Sean Wilson. Let's go around the ACC. It's presented by Mattress Firm.
Well, Tom, you mentioned that really a signature moment for Lamar Jackson against Florida State a year ago. It kind of put him on the map on the way to the net to win the Heisman Trophy. Close game down there in Tallahassee right now. D.C. Virginia, big game for both those two teams. And later on, a huge win in South Florida, Tom. Syracuse travels after beating Clemson a week ago. Go down and take on the undefeated Hurricanes.
Canes with a couple of last-second victories. Last week they beat Georgia Tech on a field goal with 4 seconds remaining in that one. This is Sean Wilson. He's got a first down and more.
Yeah, there's some of that change of direction by Wilson out of the backfield. His ability to bounce it and then hit it up the field.
Saw Darrin Hall on the bench after that long run. You know, Hall's longest run of the season, Dave, had been just 12 yards, and then he breaks that long one for the Panthers.
Jock Sean Wilson is a guy that's gotten off to a good start here early.
Yeah, he has, and I talked to him earlier this week. He said he wanted to focus on being more patient in the inside runs. He said at times he got a little impatient. Now he's starting to slow down and let those blocks develop, as we saw that last first run, actually.
Jones pass complete to Ramming, and he's got a first down on back-to-back plays.
Yeah, nice play by Ramming that time. Really did a good job of circling out. Hamlin's going to try to track him. The safety, Ramming catches it, pirouettes, and then gets up the field for a first down. They need some more of that from T.J. Ramming. His ability to catch and run is something that they valued since he's been here.
Last two play calls by offensive coordinator Zach Roper for Duke, resulting in 12 yards each, and they approach midfield. Jones trying to run away from pressure. Lost the handle on it. Players pile on. Who's got the football? Daniel Jones was being tracked down from behind and then had it knocked away by Avante Maddox. Yeah. It's going to be Pittsburgh ball.
Tom, a late shift by Pitt defensively gets Maddox up on the edge, and he's going to come untouched off the edge, and Jones just wasn't able to get away from one of the faster players here. Here's Maddox right here, going to come right off the edge, and Jones just can't get out of there in time after the play fake, and a strip by Avante Maddox, and then the scramble for the ball, and Pitt comes up with it with another short field opportunity. This is an area that Pitt has struggled in mightily this year. When they get a takeaway in a short field situation, must cash it in.
Rashad Wheeler recovered for Pittsburgh. Up 7-0, they've got the football back on the Duke 37. Danucci rolling right. Cannot find a receiver, and he's pushed out of bounds.
Well, nice job by Duke on the bootleg play. Took care of Quadre Henderson in the flat. No throw down the field. DiNucci does the respect thing and tucks it. But Ben Humphreys, the middle back, are going to track it. Let's take a look at what's available. Yeah, here's Henderson here. Here's the tight end, the downfield throw. Nothing available for DiNucci. He pulls it down, and that's the next best thing. Might have could have thrown the ball away to avoid the two-yard loss, but Ben Humphreys tracking him from the middle backer spot.
Humphreys gets credited with a sack and a two-yard loss for the Panthers. Now second and 12. The 39 of Duke. This will be a handoff to Hall. This run, quite a bit less than his previous run, just a yard for Darrin Hall.
It's a very active defensive front Duke has. Talking to Jim Knowles, the defensive coordinator for Duke. About as excited as I've seen Jim in a long time about how good his defensive front is. They're physical. He says what it's allowed us to do is allowed us to free our linebackers up. We don't have to blitz quite as much. We can let those big guys up front kind of battle. Might let Joe Giles Harris and Ben Humphreys flow and get to the football.
Eighth year on the staff for Jim Knowles, trying to defend third and 11. DiNucci, a crumbling pocket, has to throw off the back foot. It's up for grabs and knocked out of bounds. Wow. Looking for Jester Wea in traffic.
And not a good idea to throw it when that guy's in the area. Brian Fields is the guy that leads the team in interceptions. But Giles Harris is going to pressure him. You see Ben Humphreys, 34, also there. And a really a poor decision by DiNucci to throw this up the field. Brian Fields, number 14. One of the best interceptors in the country, was tracking it.
The Fields has three interceptions. Now T.J. Ramming. He's back at the 10-yard line. Ryan Winslow punting for Pittsburgh, and he got that one away at the last moment. There is a flag on the field. That one takes a bounce back towards the 5-yard line. 33 yards on the punt. But again, there is a penalty marker.
Looks like a Tom Wormy wedge right there. He's hit it right in there close to the pin. This is the second time Duke's been close to blocking the kick. He just overruns it. And he attacked the ball. He blocks that.
Holding on the kicking team, number 61. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay fourth down.
Yeah, you're going to make them re-kick there. They downed it inside the five. So Coach Cutcliffe will have them re-kick that. You know, Coach Cutcliffe talks, anytime you get a chance to talk to him, he talks about hidden yardage. He's a big proponent of special teams and putting his best players on special teams, and how can we find an extra 10, 15 yards in the exchange of kicks. He's going to make Pitt prove that they can knock it down inside the 10 again here.
So Winslow again to punt from his 37-yard line. Ramming's at the 10 waiting for it. From the 7. Looking for a block, trying to go around that corner. Two flags are out as he goes out of bounds beyond the 25-yard line. In fact, there are 5 penalty markers on the field. 5. That is a new record.
That would be what we call a yard sale.
Some serious laundry. David Epperly is our referee today.
Unsportsmanlike on the kicking team, number 61, participating without a helmet on, half the distance to the goal from the end of the run. First down, Duke.
Cal Adamitis, number 61.
And you wonder, how does his helmet come off? Well, most coaches, if you have the player that had the helmet come off, he's going to say, well, somebody tore his helmet off his head. Where's the illegal hands to the face? And that's where Coach Narduzzi is coming from right now. He's livid.
All right, here's our Duke Energy standings in the ACC.
Well, some would say NC State's in control, but they still have to play Clemson. So I think that's going to be quite a matchup. And Syracuse still has a little something to say about it. Miami taking on those Syracuse Orange today. How about Virginia now? Virginia's quietly laying in the weeds for Bronco Mendenhall. They got BC today. Pitt next week, so Virginia kind of trying to throw their hat in the ring quietly. Nobody paying attention to the Cavaliers.
By the way,
I know
Virginia,
that's really upsetting to Stan back in the studio as well.
Virginia's never beaten Boston College. That'll also upset Stan.
Yeah.
BC's 5-0 against the Cavs. So
get ready for A.J. Cannon coming, or A.J. Dillon coming at you.
Best start of the day for the Blue Devils. Jones. Shoulder down at the 45-yard line. Ran into Jordan Whitehead on the tackle.
Well, Daniel Jones, we talked about it. Jordan Whitehead came up and made the play. DJ talked about him and his ability to play both sides of the ball. But Daniel Jones is a guy that, boy, I think they're really excited about him. I think he was forced into action a year ago as a freshman, learned on the job. A little bit of a swoon here the last couple of games. He needs some players to play around him a little bit better, but he's got all the tools.
Sean Wilson, very close to a first down. DJ?
You guys talking about Daniel Jones and all he brings to this offense, and obviously he's been voted a captain this year, only the sophomore, but that speaks volumes of what his teammates think of him, and also the way he's throwing down the field. When we talked to Coach Cutty, he talked about he has to be in a state of readiness at all times and making sure that he's always ready to pull the trigger, especially in this offense when they got to get it going.
Jones with the handoff to Sean Wilson. The last play went good enough for a first down, and that Wilson picks up 5 yards on the carry.
Tommy talked to Daniel yesterday, and Shock was talking to me. When you listen to Daniel Jones speak, very mild-mannered guy. You almost had to lean forward to listen to him. And I said, hey, has this guy got, like, some pit bull in him when the thing starts? They said, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. He was just putting on the very polite face for he talked to you guys. He can light it up when he needs to.
Britton Brown on the carry, the redshirt freshman, taken down by Salim Brightwell. Also, Avante Maddox in on the stop.
Playing out much like Duke would like it to play out now. The run game has been very effective. Daniel Jones a part of that. Obviously, Wilson has carried the ball. Britton Brown has carried the ball. Exactly what Coach Cutcliffe wants. And now you're in a very manageable third down situation here where you got run pass available.
Duke has converted twice on three attempts on third down. Short yardage situation for Britton Brown, and that's a first down close to the 36-yard line. He got three, and Duke continues to move it.
Yeah, Britton Brown comes into the game averaging almost 6 yards a carry. The freshman, boy, they're excited about this kid. Canton, Georgia, went to Cherokee High School. A little bit bigger body than Sean Wilson, a little bit more power. Zach Roper upstairs calling the shots for the Duke offense.
Pressure coming. Jones got it away. It's ramming. He's out of bounds. The 27-yard line. 9 yards on the pass. Maddox forced him out.
That's a great matchup, Ramming and Maddox. Blitz comes off his right side. Jones knows it's coming. Excellent job of setting his feet, delivering the ball. Ramming had a little bit of cushion from Maddox on the outside. Good recognition of Jones to realize he had a soft corner to his left, meaning he was playing off. He could get the ball out of his hands quickly to Ramming.
Second and short. Britton Brown inside the 20. Brown made a great initial move to avoid contact, and he chews up 11.
It's something that's bothered this Pitt defense all year long, Tom, is their ability to get the run stop. Came in giving up almost 180 yards a game and almost 5 yards a carry. Britton Brown, the freshman, just talked about him, takes advantage, nice cutback, and another first down. Now they push it inside the red zone.
Jones. Inside the 10.
Boy, how about the patience on Jones here to step in behind the block? He's going to get a key block right in front of him, right there. Just steps in behind it. Excellent patience. Faked a little toss play wide, and Zach Roper doing a nice job of calling plays here. Duke has really struggled down here in the red zone.
11th in the conference in red zone offense. Driving straight ahead is Britton Brown.
And this will help them, Tom. If you can run the ball in the red zone, it makes things much bigger than they really are down there. You must be able to run it.
Just 15 seconds to go in this first quarter with Duke knocking on the door and trailing 7-0. So now Quentin Harris has committed quarterback, the sophomore from Wilton, Connecticut. Jones on the sidelines. 10th play of the drive for Duke. Started at their own 42 and whistles Hall play because that is the end of the first quarter. So the Blue Devils trying to defend the home turf at Wallace Wade Stadium. Trailing 7-0 but threatening. Second quarter straight ahead on the ACC Network.
I got a mortgage.
USAA to me means peace of mind. We had a power outage for 5 days total. We lost a lot of food. We actually filed a claim to USAA to replace that spoiled food. We really appreciated that. We're the Weber family, and we're USAA members for life.
With tomatoes, ooh, 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 and onions, and thick carved turkey breasts. I'm carved turkey. For a limited time, cranberry mustard sauce, man, that looks good. The Autumn Carved Turkey is back for a limited time at Subway.
Well, just a moment ago here at Wallace Wade Stadium, Steve Spurrier honored for his induction coming up in December into the College Football Hall of Fame as a coach, already in as a player. Head coach here from 87 to 89, Dave, and an ACC championship in his years at Duke.
The head ball coach. Boy, what a great one he's been. And think about that, Tom. Four guys have gone in as a player and a coach. And we'll get to some of those numbers and some of those other guys. Think about that. See if you can come up with the other guys that have been voted in as a player and a coach. We'll give it to you later on.
Britton Brown on the carry. Steve Spurrier is scheduled to join us in the third quarter as well, so we look forward to that. Our first quarter stats are brought to you by Nicorette.
Well, the big play, obviously the 79-yard touchdown run for Pitt has been the big play of the game, but really Duke has controlled the football, doing a good job on third down conversions. The one turnover did not cost them. Their defense came in and got a three and out. So we got Daniel Jones back in the game here, and Pitt threatening for an opportunity to put their score on the board.
Second and goal for Duke. Jones looking toward the end zone. Back of the end zone, incomplete.
He missed him. He missed him, Tom. Copenhaver, who we talked about, is one of our Food Lion Impact players, is a guy that was open early. Watch 81 flash right now. There he is right there getting the ball. Just did not see him early enough. And as it turned out, he got to him late, but by then Pitt had closed and took away the window. Copenhaver comes in with three touchdowns on the year. He's been a good weapon down here.
Britton Brown is the back. 3 for 4 on third down. This is third and goal for the Blue Devils. Jones still has it. Jones down to the 2. Some tough running and determined. He got 4 yards on the play, but came up short of the goal line. Ran into DeMar Hamlin.
Now, Hamlin's kind of been that guy, Tom, roving in the middle, trying to come down and take away those kind of in between the pitch and the quarterback runs. And Duke's kept their offense on the field here. A lot of times you want to take points early. The field goal.
Yeah, you saw Coach Pat Narduzzi running down the sideline, and he wanted to take that timeout before this fourth and goal play for the Blue Devils. 30-second
timeout. This is something that Duke had decided to do early in the Miami game. Tom, a game you and I came over and DJ Shockett came over and watched as fans on a Friday night before our game over at NC State. And early in that game, Duke drove the length of field against a really good Miami defense and went for it on fourth down near the Miami 10 and did not get it. And as it turned out, the game turned against them and Miami went on to win the football game. So that's the part you're playing with as a coach right here. Do I take the points, the 3, or do I want to end this drive? It's been a really good drive, like end it with 7.
Now that loss against Miami, Dave, on September 29th, it was here at Wallace Wade Stadium, 31-6, the start of a 3-game losing streak for David Cutcliffe of the Blue Devils, coming off the loss against Florida State a week ago.
And that was a game that Miami scored twice in the fourth quarter to make it 31-7. So Jones back on the field. I think this is I think you got to give Jones the opportunity, potentially run pass option. Running back in the game is Brown, the freshman. Ramming outside wide right here, the leading receiver.
13th play of the drive, and it does not develop. A flag is out of the end zone.
Offense, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Well, that'll certainly simplify things. I would think there'd be field goal unit now.
So it's a delayed game out of the timeout that Narduzzi called for Pittsburgh.
Yeah, just caught napping a little bit there. If you're the quarterback, you got to understand where the play clock is, and that's one Daniel Jones got to get that ball snapped.
So now a field goal attempt for Austin Parker. This will be a 25-yard attempt for Parker, trying to put Duke on the board early second quarter. So the Blue Devils took 13 plays, but they get 3 points out of it with the Austin Parker field goal. We'll be back after these messages from the University of Pittsburgh and Duke.
Found it.
Isn't this special? Nervous anticipation inside and out.
NHL.tv, the way to watch live hockey.
First little dog. Leaving a career to follow a calling takes courage. Was too.
Second little doggy had great big spots, and he's got a new pair of shoes.
See how a personalized financial strategy and access to J.P. Morgan investment expertise can help you.
Ball. Team number 51, 10-yard penalty, first down.
So the penalty.
76-yard run there, Tom. Yeah.
The penalty goes against Pittsburgh on the return. Jordan Whitehead, Dave, number 9, utilized on both sides of the football by the Panthers.
Yeah, and it's a little curious to me. I got to be honest with you. Shock, Whitehead in the game, outstanding athlete on offense. You got a guy like Quadri Henderson, you kind of wonder where you draw the line on that one.
Yeah, Art, what's so interesting is they just had that long drive, came off to the sideline. He never went to the defensive side of the bench. He came right to receivers, Coach Kevin Sherman, and now you can see he's in the game as a kind of a decoy on the jet sweep.
More often than not, when Whitehead checks in the game, they give him the ball. They said they wanted to get away with from some of the definite number nine carrying the ball. Here he's kind of that jet sweep eye candy, if you will, like Shock was talking about. But he's a guy that about 80% of the time he's in the game, he gets the ball. So it's interesting how they play those two guys, Tom. You know, now Quadri Henderson back in the game right here, who is essentially the same guy.
Whitehead has three rushing touchdowns in his career. It's Henderson, the motion man. They gave it to him. Head of steam and out of bounds up near the 25-yard line. Quadri Henderson, 9 yards and a first down. Fields had to make the stop.
Yeah, Henderson has been a guy like this has been who he's been for the last couple years for Pitt. Just a guy that can make explosive plays and get your runs that get your first downs. He does an outstanding job with that. Just had 28 touches coming into the game. That's his 29th touch here on offense. Averaging right at 8.5 yards a touch.
Over 2,000 all-purpose yards last season for Henderson. Now DiNucci. Quarterback run up to the 31-yard line. 7 yards for Ben DiNucci, the sophomore from Wexford, Pennsylvania.
It's a zone read play here for DiNucci. Read the edge, pull it out. Not sure they're overly excited about that, but his hook slides short of the first down, so it's second and 3 here. DiNucci's a guy that brings that nice little element of ability to run. See, Pitt's tried to play the power game with the run game. There's 2 passing attempts for DiNucci so far.
They swing it out to the left side with Hall. Past the 30, up near the 35-yard line, and a first down for the Panthers as Gilbert made the tackle defensively for Duke.
Darrell Revis' cousin. We talked about Revis and we saw him earlier. But this is an excellent play by Hall because he runs out of the tackle of Ben Humphreys. Really nice job by Hall. He's made the big run today that put points on the board. And then a nice run there to avoid the tackle for loss and get a first down.
First completion of the game for the Panthers. From their own 35, DiNucci rolling right. Let it go near the 40. And the catch was made. 5 yards on the grab.
And they're calling out of bounds, Tom. Side judge comes down and says, no, he's out of bounds. Got the ball out there too late. He had a little natural pick to Quadri Olison, who slipped out of the backfield. DiNucci was looking up the field and didn't have, he had Olison right away. Had he got him the ball, he probably could have turned up the sideline. Let's see if he was able to. Well, it looks like that right foot is down before the left foot hits the ground.
Dave, there's an official right in front of this play, and he called it a completion. The play is now under review.
Yeah, the side judge came down the sideline and called it out of bounds. So
David Epperle was on the headset waiting for the official word. Again, the ruling on the field.
The field is confirmed. Incomplete pass. Second down.
First official thought it was a catch. It's now been confirmed as an incomplete pass. It was Olison who made the grab on the sideline, but unable to avoid stepping out of bounds before making that grab. Second and 10 for Pittsburgh. Olison, 43-yard line, 8 yards. Quadri Olison, Alonzo Saxton made the tackle.
Olison in 2015, Tom, burst on the scene when James Conner was injured and then they discovered that James Conner had cancer. Olison became that guy as a freshman, ran for over 100 yards 5 times. He carried for 1,100 yards rushing and 11 touchdowns. And then Conner, of course, returned a year ago. Dramatic comeback for James Conner. Had a monster year, and Olison went back to more of a reserve role. Looking for Olison to step up. Nice run there on second down.
One for three on third down for the Panthers. Olsen got the call again up near midfield, and the chains are rolling as we go back to Charlotte.
Let's check in Tallahassee, where everything's falling the Noles' way.
Yeah, you got Kandar right there at the defensive end holding up Lamar. The vocal Matthew Thomas felt like they could bottle up Lamar all week. You set him up, I'll knock him down. Matthew Thomas for a touchdown.
Boston College had that dramatic win against Louisville last week when we were in Louisville, Kentucky. This is DiNucci now going left side. Saxton again beating his progress after a four-yard gain.
Yeah, we're seeing DiNucci's ability time to kind of stretch this defense sideline to sideline. It's something they're going to have to pay attention to. He's got enough to pick up first downs, to extend drives, to certainly put him in good manageable play call situations. He's doing a nice job with his ability to move around, and it's Jim Knowles, defensive coordinator for Duke, trying to solve that puzzle.
Two games for you next week here on the ACC Network, including a primetime matchup as the Blue Devils travel to Blacksburg to take on the Hokies. DiNucci stumbles as he steps to about the 48.5-yard line, just a yard. Jordan Hayes on the tackle.
Well, Ben Humphreys, 34, is going to shoot in, eat up the block of Olsen right there, and now one-on-one on the outside. Hayes has an opportunity to get the ball carrier on the ground, the quarterback. Shock.
One thing you want to watch is when they run this zone read, they're doing a good job of not blocking that end, and they're forcing him to make a decision. The last couple of times, the end has crashed, and that's given DiNucci the ability to get around the corner. If he squares his shoulders and he gives it to him, the running back's downhill right now. He's getting 3-4 yards before he gets touched.
Yeah, reading it extremely well. That time, Duke was able to defend.
Yeah, there's 2 for 4 on third down. That's a low pass, but Rafael Arujo Lopes makes the catch. About the 41-yard line. Jeremy McDuffie on the tackle. That is really close to a first down.
Well, our first down line, obviously unofficial, but based on that, Arujo Lopes about a yard short of the first down, and that's what the officials have said as well. And Pitt will keep their offense on the field. Got the big back in the game in Quadre Olsen.
Panthers 9 of 14 on the season when they go for it on fourth down. Fourth and inches. Olsen crashing into the line of scrimmage, has enough just inside the 40. 3 yards on the run, had a first down Panthers.
It's like they tried to run in behind big Alex Officer, number 63. 340-pound guard, looked like he got enough of a push. Olsen fell right in behind him for the first down. It's a huge offensive line that Pitt has lined up in front of Olsen.
Panthers there at 2-5 on the season, 0-3 in conference play. This is the 12th play of the drive, and they hand it off to Hall. Second effort, 35-yard line. Let's go to our studios in Charlotte and check in with King.
Thanks, Tom. Let's check in on that BC-Virginia game. Here come the Eagles again, Coach.
Just a short hitch by Kobe White. He turns into a 76-yard touchdown pass from Anthony Round. BC up 17-10.
And that's back-to-back 76-yard big plays, guys.
Kobe White, freshman, makes a big play. All of a sudden, BC's offense has come alive since last week.
Shaking a tackle. Jordan Whitehead. Yeah, not much after that, though.
Yeah, really an interesting spot to put him to. A little bit more of an eye look to him. Number 9 lined up right in the backfield. Kind of a diamond look, if you will, and he just keeps the football.
So 3rd and 8 now for Pittsburgh. 2 for 5 on third down for the Panthers. Ball's at about the 37 of Duke. Hall is the back to the right of DiNucci. Surveys the field. Has to get out of a deteriorating pocket. Runs inside the 30. DiNucci scrambling his way to the 26-yard line. You saw him signal it. It's a first down, Panthers, 11 yards.
Yeah, nice job by DiNucci here. Going to set up in the pocket. feels a little pressure, gonna skate to his right, realizes defenders are running with their backs turned to him, so he pulls it down and takes off. Whenever you get a team that's playing man coverage down the field, get those backs to you as a quarterback, you love that look, you're gonna take off with it every time.
15th play of this drive for the Panthers. They lead 7-3 on a 79-yard TD run by Darrin Hall in the first quarter. He has the run here. Drew Jordan has the tackle after 5 yards.
Well, this will really test you depth-wise for Duke now, trying to rotate some players on that defensive front. When you got that gigantic offensive line leaning on that defensive front that probably only goes about 6 or 7 deep in Pitt's offense so far.
The 157 rushing yards, well above their season average, Dave. Just 114 yards rushing per game for the Panthers near the bottom of the conference. DiNucci trying to fake out the defender, goes down just inside the 20.
Nice play, Jordan Hayes on the edge. He's made a couple of these plays. It's a good open field tackle because there was nobody behind Hayes had he not been able to drag DiNucci down. Hayes had 10 tackles a week ago against Florida State. Their red zone numbers, 13 TDs and 19 trips. Pretty good. Pretty good number for Pitt when they get down here. Done a nice job of finishing the drive. Right here, their goal is to extend the drive and pick up this 4 yards on third down.
DiNucci runs out of the pocket. A flag comes out. He was up close to first down yardage near the 16-yard line, but a flag was thrown on the play. Referee David Epperly.
Holding on the offense, number 67. 10-yard penalty, third down.
And get a scramble. He got it close to the sticks there. And Morrissey, one of our Food Line Impact players, the freshman, has played really well amongst this big offensive line. He's done a nice job of coming in as a redshirt freshman and taking over, calling the shots in there. 8 consecutive starts now as a freshman. But got called for the hold there.
So it will be 3rd and 13 as we go under 4 minutes to go in the first half. DiNucci, quick pass comes up short near the 20-yard line.
Oh, Duke had blown coverage, Tom, and Arujo Lopes is wide open in the flat, and DiNucci doesn't get him the ball. Pressure look from Duke, got after the quarterback, rushed his throw, but he just does not get the ball to the sideline where Arujo Lopes was. Wide open.
So Alex Kessman will come in on a 47-yard attempt. Kessman has made 5 in a row, all outside of 42 yards. So this from 47 for Kessman and Pittsburgh. And it's no good. Kessman misses after making his last 5. 16 plays on the drive, and Coach Narduzzi comes up empty.
Redskins.
Everything that we want is right in front of us.
Eagles.
No better spotlight than the entire world to see you guys perform on Monday night.
Division rivalries don't get any bigger.
Make the most of every opportunity you get, man.
Carson Wentz and the 5-1 Eagles look to cement their hold on the NFC East. Monday Night Football, Redskins, Eagles, Monday, 8:15 Eastern on ESPN.
Are you ready?
Don't miss 11 simultaneous matches on Decision Day. Coverage begins tomorrow at 4 Eastern on ESPN and MLS Live.
ACC football is brought to you by Food Lion, raising standards without raising prices. How refreshing. By your Carolina Ford dealers. By GEICO, saving people money for over 75 years. by Mattress Firm, and by Bojangles. It's bow time.
Last night inside Cameron Indoor Stadium, countdown to craziness. There's your only returning player. First, Grayson Allen going up over a couple of cheerleaders to jam that one home. This is Sean Wilson. By the way, the Duke basketball team starts November 10th, Dave, a home game against Elon.
Yeah, this Duke offense been on the field, or has not been on the field for quite a while, and immediately get back and get the ball to your best players. Sean Wilson carries the ball there. These two backs, we talked about them off the top, very good players.
Second down for Duke. Wilson swarmed under. Hamlin led the charge, and they lost one.
And probably not a very good decision here by Wilson to bounce it. Hamlin's got leverage to the outside. Number three, got to hit this straight ahead. But he bounced it, and Hamlin's able to slide out and make the play. He's made a number of plays now out on that edge area. Excellent job by Hamlin.
3 for 5 on third down for the Blue Devils. This is 3rd and 7. Need to get up near the 39-yard line. Jones, sturdy in the pocket, his pass maybe a little bit too high, and it dropped to the dirt. Incomplete looking for Taylor. Jackson on the coverage for Pittsburgh.
Yeah, this is going to be a 3 and out for Pitt. But Taylor going to come to the inside on the deep end route. Ball a little bit tall, but again, a ball on your hands. And if you're a receiver, you got to try to reel those in. Excellent coverage coming in on the backside by Dane Jackson.
So Henderson, the return man.
Yeah, 3 and out. I mean, now that defense has to get back out there. Here's Henderson.
Parker, the punt. Henderson wants the fair catch, makes it near the 28-yard line. 39 yards on the punt by Austin Parker. The beautiful campus here at Duke University in Durham. 7-3 Pitt.
Heat at 8, Wizards Lakers at 10:30, Wednesday on ESPN.
You are watching the ACC Network, an exclusive production of Raycom Sports. Our coverage of ACC football being broadcast on AFN, the American Forces Network. We welcome the men and women of the U.S. Army, Air Force, Navy, Coast Guard, and Marines stationed around the globe. So proud to have you with us. Hope you're enjoying the broadcast.
You put together these drives, 18 plays, ate up almost 10 minutes off the clock, and you missed a field goal.
27-yard missed field goal at the end of that drive. 9 minutes, 45 seconds for the previous Pittsburgh drive, Dave. Duke went 3 and out and took 1 minute and 5 seconds in their subsequent drive.
But trying to a little bit more of a sense of urgency now, under two and a half minutes to go now. And maybe too much sense of urgency as they get called for moving too quickly.
False start. Offense. Number 2. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
Well, neither team, Tom, has been able to establish anything throwing the ball. That both teams have had some success running it. But Duke wins on first down in this series on the tackle that on Henderson, just a 1-yard gain. And now they get Pitt backed up behind the chains. We'll see if Jim Knowles decides to come with some pressure to dig him deeper, or is he going to play zone? This is an aggressive defense for Duke.
By the way, the field goal missed by Kessman was 47 yards on the previous possession for the Panthers. They've got room. A.J. Davis, 38-yard line, 14 yards for Davis, the freshman, the tackle by Joe Giles Harris.
And what did they do? They played aggressively. They played man coverage. It came with a little bit of extra pressure up front. And Pitt creases them in the run game.
Panthers on third down to Davis again. He's got enough because those sticks are moving up near the 40-yard line.
Overly quickly working here. Danucci looking to the sideline. They're going to go ahead and go with a little sugar huddle here right near the ball. Clock winding down now inside 1:20. Pitt will get the ball to start the second half.
Danucci, deep. Too far for the intended receiver, Jester Weah. Brian Fields was the only player to get a piece of it.
Weah, big target at 6'3", 210, and good job by Brian Fields to keep upfield leverage. Just kind of a hard play fake, and now going to take the shot down the field. Look where Fields is. Perfect position beyond the receiver. And really, Weah just kind of trying to wave his hand in there and blur Fields' vision to keep him from picking that one off.
Fields had a 61-yard interception return for a touchdown in the fourth quarter of the big win on the road at North Carolina to take the victory bell earlier this season for Duke. Second and 10, time for Danucci. Slings it down near the 35-yard line, and the pass is on schedule to Arujo Lopes.
Well, it's excellent protection up front, Tom. That allows this deep corner route. And McDuffie, number 9, going to take a bad angle. See, he starts flat, which doesn't put him in position to make a contested play at the ball. Because he came so flat, now he just has to make the tackle to keep Arujo Lopes from scoring. So a bad angle by one of the Cheetahs back there. McDuffie's been really good so far this year for Duke.
28 yards on the pass play. Danucci back to the air. Trying to step through the pocket and tumbles down. Serenor got just enough of him to drop him, a loss of 5. And we'll be back after a word from your local ACC station.
Don't miss 11 simultaneous matches on Decision Day. Coverage begins tomorrow at 4 Eastern on ESPN and MLS Live.
It ain't easy being on top. Everyone wants to bring the trophy home.
All 130 teams.
It's gonna be a fight to the finish.
The college football playoff on ESPN.
Who's in?
Arujo Lopes, the intended receiver, Jordan Hayes, on the coverage for the Duke defense. So that brings up third and long. Again, 28 seconds to go in the half. 4 of 8 on third down for Pittsburgh. And the football spotted at the 37 of the Blue Devils. Again, the 47-yard miss from Kessman. He made 5 in a row, Dave, prior to that, all 42 yards or more.
Yeah, you're going to need to get him about 6 or 7 yards here and then burn the timeout.
Danucci, the floater, inside the 10. Both players going for it. Fields had the position, and it falls to the turf. French was also there for Pittsburgh.
This doesn't, and they're going to go ahead and try it. This is going to be a long field goal. Going to be somewhere in that 55-yard range. Like to have seen, I'm sure, Pat Narduzzi, the head coach, would have liked to have seen an underneath throw to get his kicker a little closer.
Kessman has made from 56 yards. That was at Syracuse to tie a school record earlier this year. This is officially 55 yards. He has made from this distance. That was at Georgia Tech. Kessman doesn't have enough. Off the mark. Off the mark for Kessman, who's now 0 for 2, but both field goals, long ones, 47 and 55 yards. So we'll step aside. Just a few seconds to go here. In our second quarter, Kessman misses from long distance.
Give up, Skelly.
Don't miss the Decision Day action on ESPN and MLS Live.
Action in the ACC. We're going to talk about it coming up on the PNC Investments Halftime Report.
Boston College, a season's worth of big plays in the first half. 24-0, Virginia defense struggling.
Louisville needed Lamar Jackson to be Superman. Throw for one, ran for one.
Let's head back to Durham.
Back in Durham. Duke with just 15 seconds on the clock. Jones on the design run. Puts the shoulder down at the 45-yard line. He got 8. Idowu on the tackle.
Yeah, Pitt came with pressure off the wide side of the field. Good decision by Jones to pull it down. Now you got your timeouts if you're Duke here to provide. Probably looking at maybe two plays here and one play potentially to get yourself in field goal range, or you get yourself down where Jones can throw the jump ball and give yourself a chance potentially at the end of the half for a Hail Mary throw. See how they play this. Probably need to get this ball for a realistic shot somewhere in that about 20 yards down the field around the Pitt 35-yard line.
Austin Parker has connected for the only Duke points, a 25-yard field goal in the second quarter.
His long is 45.
Made that against Baylor in mid-September.
Been playing off now. They're giving him the sideline, though. You could make a throw out in this area out here at the top.
Jones, the pass.
There it is.
What a catch. Chris Taylor, 31-yard line.
If you cut, go ahead and take the timeout. There it is.
Yeah, they got 24 yards on the pass play, 4 seconds on the clock, and a timeout.
Well, they gave up the sideline. They played deep and then gave up the sideline. It's an excellent catch by Taylor. This is exactly what Duke wanted, was to attack the sideline. Taylor squeezes it. Ball scored for the first down. Clock stops because of the moving of the chains. And, of course, Coach Cutcliffe ran down the field. And burn the timeout.
Dave, did that football glance off the helmet of the defender and Taylor? A slight adjust? I mean, what a catch. DJ?
Fellas, Duke hasn't done much of anything in his first half offensively. You give him a chance to go into the locker room with a little confidence that they're able to make this field goal, but Adol never looks back on that particular play to even give himself a chance to break that ball up.
Well, an excellent concentration play by Taylor, and now you've got a field goal. Now, this will be his long of the year, just 45, made a 45-yarder.
A light breeze helping Austin Parker from 49 yards away, has converted from 25 yards away, and now Pittsburgh will take a timeout. It's a long 15 seconds, Dave. When we came back, there were 15 seconds on the clock, and now Duke has a chance at points. Fans, your local Toyota dealers want to take you to the 2017 Dr. Pepper ACC Football Championship game. Visit the acc.com/Toyota tickets to enter for two tickets and a pregame photo on the field at Bank of America Stadium in Charlotte, North Carolina, December 2nd.
Now Parker comes in having made his last five kicks. Tom coming in with the kick already today. 45 is his long. He has one, had one blocked.
So officially 49 yards with 4 seconds to go in the second quarter. Austin Parker out of the hold of Bane. It was deflected. Pittsburgh wisely staying away from the football. We'll be down at the 10.
Couldn't tell if that got blocked off the edge or if it got blocked through the middle. It's obviously in the middle there. Tell who got a paw on it.
Maybe 78, Dave. Alex Butzer in the middle, but
put the offensive lineman in there to try to block it.
That attempt blocked from Parker, so a made field goal from 29, but a miss from 49. And the teams will head to the locker room. Pittsburgh, which dominated the second period as far as time of possession is concerned, came up empty, 7-3, down to DJ.
Coach, you put up 170 rush yards in that first half. What was working for you guys offensively?
107 rush yards, but only 7 points. So we got to score more points. I mean, it comes down to it. They're a good football team. Our kids are, I think our running backs are running hard. Our offensive line's blocking hard. And I'd like to get another 170 in the second half with another 14 or 21 points.
Are you happy with the way your defense is playing right now, holding Duke to only 3 points and not much on the ground, really?
Yeah, I mean, that was a big field goal block, I think, by our left tackle. You know, he cut, you know, a pass last week. He gets a block there on an important field goal. Yeah, they're okay. I mean, 30 minutes more to go. You know, it ain't a 30-minute game.
All right, Coach, thank you. Really scrappy game here in the first half at Wallace Wade Stadium. Pitt up 7-3. Should be interesting second half. Katie, take it away in the studio.
Thanks, DJ. It definitely was a
Welcome to the Capital One Halftime Report.
Welcome to the Capital One Halftime Report. I'm Cassidy Hubbard. We have a great day of college football across our ESPN networks. Let's check in with our college football studio team.
Taking the field during the whiteout is something that, I mean, you can feel the energy in the stadium. You feel the ground almost shaking.
Coming out through the gates, the fireworks, the under the lights, just seeing a sea of white, it's an amazing feeling.
The word whiteout means the opposing team is basically celebrating us, our entry into their stadium. I think it's really nice of Penn State.
We definitely have the confidence because we've been building confidence all year. So we're excited to play in this environment against them, and we're ready to show up this Saturday.
As we welcome you, hope you're enjoying your first half. Cannot wait for Penn State, Michigan. Joey Galloway, Jesse Palmer, I'm Adnan Verk. Nittany Lions have won 15 straight regular season games since losing to the Wolverines last season. And we can talk about all the matches we want, Jesse, but really it's this. Saquon Barkley against Michigan's run defense.
This is the definition of a Heisman moment on national TV during a whiteout at Penn State. Saquon Barkley against one of the best defenses in the country in Michigan. And Saquon Barkley, guys, has been fantastic all season long, averaging 217 all-purpose yards a game. That leads the country. Whether it's running between the tackles, whether it's catching the football, making big returns in the return game, he impacts the game every time he touches the football. But I think Michigan's defense is built to slow him down. They are extremely athletic on the defensive line, and they love movement. They stunt, they twist, they slant. They can create a lot of penetration and make plays in the backfield. You know, guys, we've seen some games this year for Penn State where they kind of use Saquon Barkley as a decoy early in the game. They weren't really giving him the football to try to set up some play-action pass opportunities. I think this is one of those games you got to force feed number 26. He cannot touch the football enough if Penn State's going to win at home.
Yeah, and if you watch a Northwestern game against Penn State and what that defense did against Saquon Barkley, they slowed him down because at the mesh point between McSorley and Saquon Barkley, they decided we're taking Barkley. We're going to see if McSorley can beat us with his feet. And the read option is a key play in this Penn State offense. So here's the mesh point. Watch the defensive end. His eyes are on Saquon Barkley. I'm going Barkley. Let McSorley go beat us for 3 yards. Let him get his 3 yards. We'll line up at second and seven. Here's the mesh point again. Defensive end, the safety, linebacker, they're all going with Barkley. In this situation, they're like, McSorley who? Let him keep it. Let's slow down Saquon Barkley. And it works out for Penn State in this situation because, again, you see both linebackers, you see the defensive end. Go with Barkley, and you'll see McSorley get this ball into the end zone. If they can slow down Saquon Barkley and force Tracy McSorley to beat them, then that's advantage Michigan. I just think Penn State will come in with a different game plan. The read option might not be the play to run against a talented Michigan defense. Find different ways to get Barkley the ball out in space.
Love a good mesh point.
Yeah.
Another major game to look forward to is USC and Notre Dame. Of course, it is a classic rivalry. It's even better when both teams are really good. Both these teams ranked, in fact, in the top 15. Notre Dame, they'll beat USC potentially, but they got to have Brandon Wimbush playing well, right?
Yeah, this is a great rushing offense. They're averaging 308 rushing yards a game, but Brandon Wimbush, he struggled throwing the football. Right now, only completing 52% of his throws. And in critical junctures in games, he's missed open wide receivers. He's probably not 100% in this game with a foot injury that forced him to miss his game against UNC last week. He might not be as effective as a runner, so he's going to have to make plays throwing the football and help this offense gain explosive plays against USC.
And Sam Darnold did not throw a pick last weekend, but he needs help in what area of the game?
I'm going opposite of you, Jess. You think Notre Dame needs to pass it to have a chance to win. USC, not Sam Darnold, but Ronald Jones Jr., they need to run the ball. If they can run the ball better than Notre Dame runs the ball in this game, then USC has a chance to win. And Ronald Jones Jr. is a talented running back. Averages 6 yards a carry, 100 yards per game. But we don't know that because we always talk Sam Darnold. If they can run it, it takes a lot of pressure off Sam Darnold in the passing game. When there's pressure on Darnold to carry this team, he's had turnovers. He's fumbled the ball. He's thrown interceptions. Take the pressure off of Darnold. Run the football. Keep Notre Dame on the sideline. Make it a short game. If they can outrush them, they win the game.
Other notable games to look forward to on college football Saturday. Plenty on the slate for week 8 as the action will continue on ABC, ESPN, and ESPN2. Syracuse taking on Miami as the Hurricanes try to stay unbeaten. Cuse coming off that electrifying win over Clemson. UNC struggling to try to turn up a notch against Virginia Tech. LSU resurgent now, especially with that defense. And after that win against Auburn, they're at Ole Miss, 7:15 Eastern on ESPN. And also don't forget the Hoosiers and Spartans on
Old
ABC.
Old brass platoon.
Whenever there's a trophy game. Exactly. Colorado at Washington State as well. Luke Falk had a dreadful game against Cal. The 5 interceptions, was sacked 9 times.
Why are you
times.
Bringing up old stuff?
I'm just saying, can he bounce back against Colorado?
Let him move on.
Something to look forward to.
Sheesh.
10:45.
Spurs Heat at 8. Wizards Lakers at 10:30. Wednesday on ESPN.
Redskins.
Everything that we want is right in front of us.
Eagles.
No better spotlight than the entire world to see you guys perform on Monday night.
Division rivalries don't get any bigger.
Make the most of every opportunity you get, man.
Carson Wentz and the 5-1 Eagles look to cement their hold on the NFC East. Monday Night Football, Redskins, Eagles, Monday, 8:15 Eastern on ESPN.
Are you ready?
Spurs Heat at 8. Wizards Lakers at 10:30. Wednesday on ESPN.
Warning. Whiteout conditions expected in Happy Valley tonight.
This could be a very tough environment.
We're in October. And this is where things start to get real.
Redskins.
Everything that we want is right in front of us.
Eagles.
No better spotlight than the entire world to see you guys perform on Monday night.
Division rivalries don't get any bigger.
Make the most of every opportunity you get, man.
Carson Wentz and the 5-1 Eagles look to cement their hold on the NFC East. Monday Night Football, Redskins, Eagles, Monday, 8:15 Eastern on ESPN.
Are you ready?
Welcome back to the Capital One Halftime Report.
Penn State's freakishly talented running back Saquon Barkley burst onto the scene in the Rose Bowl and is running his way into and perhaps through the Heisman conversation. Jen Lotta caught up with the Nittany Line to talk about how he went from questioning his love of football to leaping into the spotlight.
Look out! Saquon Barkley! Can he go the distance? Yes, he can!
I want to go down as one of the best running backs to ever play at Penn State.
It's Barkley trying to bounce it. He does escape. Saquon Barkley in the clear.
He's blessed with unbelievable talent.
Still got it! Saquon Barkley all the way to the end zone. Electric!
He's the best football player I've ever seen.
When Saquon Barkley scored 3 touchdowns in the 2017 Rose Bowl, everything around him, the attention, the expectation, even the Heisman hype, grew. And yet, the junior running back's ego never did.
We
We call him the humble superstar.
I don't see it being humble. I just see it being who I am and how am I supposed to be. And I don't really see myself as a superstar.
You know, having all the accolades and all the success that he's having on the field, he's still the same person off the field.
My dad and my mom always told me you can do anything you put your mind to, and as long as you have hard work, nothing's gonna come easy, nothing's gonna get handed to you, but if you work for it, anything's possible.
Saquon Barkley leaps, and he goes. That's a touchdown.
When I take that to football field, you kind of feel unstoppable.
Today, he is one of the biggest names in the sport, but early in his career at Whitehall High School in Pennsylvania, he questioned his future in football.
I was like real small. I was like 5'7", 155, going to my sophomore year. Everyone would start growing and I would just stay in the same size. Couldn't just rely on natural talent anymore.
When he couldn't lift or do some things that the older kids could or some of his peers could, he'd get frustrated. And his way of handling it was maybe just to step away from it. I explained to him that this is what you need to do. You know, you need to have some confidence in yourself, get in the weight room, you know, work a little bit harder, and he jumped on that.
The address of the weight room has changed, but Saquon's commitment to getting bigger and stronger has not.
Coming to my freshman year, I looked at the running back board and I said, before I leave this place, I want every single top category in a running back. I was able to do that in like a couple months.
He's just a freak. We came in as freshmen and like pretty much lifted the same weights, and then all of a sudden, like the next winter, he was just going like 30, 40, 50 pounds over me and everything. He's just a different breed.
You know, if you look at the 225 bench press, I want to say he did 33 reps the other day in our workout, and when we tested, he did 31, and he was disappointed because it was a bad day because he's done 33 before.
I'd use that to, like, motivate me to when times are getting rough in the field. You feel like your body's banged up and you're going to the fourth corner, and you got to find that way. You got to find that will.
Saquon Barkley's don't come around very often. I've been doing this for 23 years at every level. I've never seen anybody like him.
Barkley will continue his pursuit to getting the Nittany Lions back on top and along the way, maybe pick up Penn State's first Heisman Trophy since John Cappelletti took home the school's only Heisman hardware in 1973. That'll do it for the Capital One Halftime Report. I'm Cassidy Hubbard. Stay tuned to the ESPN family of networks for all your college football coverage throughout the day. Enjoy the second half.
I'm so in love with you. Whatever you want to do is all right with me.
Larry, you gotta get those burgers off the grill.
Doug Flutie? Who threw the Hail Larry?
You mean a Hail Mary?
Tomato potato, man.
Those are two different words.
Let's go, Dr. Pepper hip! Let's go!
Spurs Heat at 8, Wizards Lakers at 10:30, Wednesday on ESPN.
Redskins.
Everything that we want is right in front of us.
Eagles.
No better spotlight than the entire world to see you guys perform on Monday night.
Division rivalries don't get any bigger.
Make the most of every opportunity you get, man.
Carson Wentz and the 5-1 Eagles look to cement their hold on the NFC East. Monday Night Football, Redskins, Eagles, Monday, 8:15 Eastern on ESPN.
Are you ready?
college football playoff era. Four teams. Two semifinals. New Year's Day. The college football playoff on ESPN. Who's in?
Pitt owned the football in the second quarter. Duke owned it in the first quarter. So we got a guy in the booth here. We'd like to see us throw the ball over.
We'll get to that in just a second, okay. Dave. Right now, let's go to DJ Shockley.
Coach, what do you got to do to get your offense going here in the second half?
We can't let the first half define who we are. We're going to give our players and our playmakers more chances than what we did. We can't play like that and be successful here.
All right, Coach, have a good one. Pitt gets the ball coming out of the second half. Should be entering the first half. Can DiNucci get it going? Will be the key.
DJ, thank you very much. We look forward to our second half of play. But earlier in this game, in a break of the action, Steve Spurrier, the legendary head coach who was here in the late 80s and led this program to an ACC championship, honored because he is going into the College Football Hall of Fame as a coach. He's already in as a player, and we have the privilege of watching Coach Spurrier and the things that he was able to do. And look at this resume, and it includes a national championship, Dave, at Florida as well.
Well, I've had the great pleasure of getting to know Steve Spurrier over his career, and I'm not sure why he didn't recruit me to come to Duke back in 1980, but when you... Coach, really appreciate your time. Head ball coach with us. Steve, when you came here in 1980, after being at Georgia Tech, came here in 1980 as the offensive coordinator, why was this a good fit for you to come here?
Well, it's the only fit, Dave. Fortunately, I'd met Coach Red Wilson at Dunwoody High School in Atlanta doing spring recruiting before that 79 season at Georgia Tech. We all get fired. And Bill Curry told me I was a candidate for quarterback coach, but he couldn't guarantee anything. So Duke had an opening for offensive coordinator, and I called up. Coach Red Wilson called. I went up, visited, and got hired. So I owe Duke University everything as far as my coaching career. So I got hired then, and then I went to the USFL. 3 years later, we had back-to-back winning seasons. These kids could really play ball here, especially the quarterbacks and receivers. And then after USFL folded, another opening occurred, and Tom Butters hired me to come back here in 87 through 89. And, of course, that 89 year, we sort of put it all together and won the ACC.
Well, Steve, you've always had a great knack for finding quarterbacks. You talk about you had Ben Bennett come in here, Anthony Dilwig. I mean, you had some really good quarterbacks.
I tell you what, I coached four guys. We were just looking at the wall in the Yost Center here at Duke. And four of the guys were ACC Players of the Year, Anthony Dilwig and Ben Bennett, and then two receivers, Chris Kastner and Clarkson Hines. So we had some really, talk about playmakers and what Coach Cutler just said. And I'll tell you what, the students used to really come out back in those days. And every time we'd hit a long pass, they'd yell, air ball, just like over in Cameron Indoor Stadium. Air ball, air ball. Coach, so that was really fun.
Let's flash you back. Take us back to 1989 and the excitement around the program.
Okay, I guess this is the North Carolina game.
This was the big win against North Carolina.
Well,
yeah.
they weren't all that good that year. They were 1-10, I think. But we had to beat them to win the ACC. So that was the first one, I think, since 62.
Right.
And the only one since. But
6-1 record that year, All-American Bowl. I have to imagine, Coach, that when you look around to see the transformation of this particular parcel of land on campus, it is very hard to believe as Pittsburgh starts with possession of the second
half. Yeah, the facilities here are as good as anywhere. They really are. Kevin White, the athletic director, and the boosters that have the money to give, they have done a super job. Everything's here to be very successful. Just got to go win, keep it up, win successfully, recruit maybe a little bit better. But Coach Cutcliffe has won a division. He has played for a championship. This year's team may not be quite that caliber, but it can be done here at Duke University.
Yeah, they won their first four games of the year trying to stop a three-game losing streak. Pittsburgh has possession of the football, and that one comes to the near side out of bounds near the 25-yard line.
Steve, when you talk about when you were so good at designing things and attacking people's defenses and their weaknesses, one of these plays that's kind of become in vogue here is this jet sweep. came across. If I'm not mistaken, you guys were doing that way back in the day, but here's a kid, Henderson, carrying the ball as an explosive play.
Yeah, we did do that under center. Of course, everybody's in the shotgun now. We didn't do it a whole bunch, just every now and then. We would do that and fake it. But what we did well in the quarterbacks and receivers, they just would run precise routes. And, it seemed to be a little easier maybe back in those days because the defensive coverages, people didn't disguise much. And they disguise a little bit better now. But we really had some receivers and quarterbacks and offensive linemen that could do it all.
You had a mention of going fast on offense. Your guys could go fast. You had the ability to change the tempo. Mm-hmm. That's now become standard operating procedure. Now, you got to take great pride in some of the things you brought to the game are now kind of what everybody wants to do.
Well, we went fast usually early in the game, but if we had the lead, that's when Randy Cuthbert would run for a bunch of yards, or whoever the tailback was. And somebody told me that the 89 ACC championship year, we were almost exactly 50-50 run pass. So just, winning teams, it's usually about like that.
It's pretty good balance.
Yeah.
Pretty good balance. One national title, one ACC title, six SEC championships. I mean, amazing career. Steve Spurrier with us here in our game with Pitt and Duke.
Yeah, hopefully before this game's over, we can be yelling airball a little bit. And I hope Coach Cutcliffe tells his offensive coordinator, I think we've only thrown that one deep pass, and he hit it for 30 yards. Let's get it up there. He said, Coach Cut, I think, said he's going to do that at halftime. So hopefully that's going to happen. All right, thanks, guys. Good to be with you.
Coach, look at this. I just want you to look at this before you go. Look at this. Only four people in the history of college football who've gone in as a player and a coach, and you are in this group. What does it mean to you to be with those other names?
Well, certainly it's unusual, and I was very fortunate, I guess, as a guy that actually was in the NFL 10 years. I was backup quarterback for 8 of the 10, so then I was fortunate to get into coaching. A lot of guys that were maybe All-American college players, they don't go into coaching. So I guess I'm just a little bit of a different dude in that manner.
The defense came up big on that third down play for you, Coach. We thank you so much.
That just really doesn't work all the time. All right, thank you, man.
Coach Spurrier, thank you for stopping by.
Congratulations.
Steve Spurrier, 1966, Heisman Trophy winner, 89, won the ACC as the head coach at Duke. Started here as an offensive coordinator in the early 80s, Dave, and it's so much fun to talk with Steve Spurrier.
And think about that, Tom, as we see a penalty now here on fourth down. It looks like Duke might have been offside, and Pitt may have a chance to extend this drive. Tom, a mistake by the kick return unit.
Offside, defense, 5-yard penalty, resulting in a first down.
And at third phase, lets Coach Cutcliffe down here, and now Pitt's going to get the ball back. But you think about, we showed you the names of the guys that have a player and a coach that go in, and just four guys. I mean, think about how many guys have gone on that were really good players and great players went on to coach. Just four guys have ever been able to do that, and Coach Spurrier certainly embodies one of the great players and coaches of all time, 66 Heisman Trophy winner, and of course now going to the College Football Hall of Fame here in 2017.
As DiNucci trying to run away from the pressure eventually goes out of bounds. Hayes made the tackle. Back to our studio in Charlotte.
Our Hardee's update takes us to Florida State, where Reggie Bonifon coming up big.
Yeah, a big Lamar run got him down there, but a versatile Reggie Bonifon with the injuries at running back is capitalizing on the opportunities.
Cards up 21-14. Tom, Dave, back to you.
Another battle between the Cards and the Seminoles, this time in Tallahassee.
We saw Bonifon break a big run for a touchdown last week against Boston College.
Yeah, Lamar Jackson is putting up the numbers, very similar numbers he put last year. He's just getting enough help, and Bonifon stepped up back-to-back weeks to help him out.
Jackson was responsible for 5 touchdowns in our game last week, except Boston College had A.J. Dillon, who ran
5-yard penalty, second down,
for 270 yards in the BC win.
Well, Coach Spurrier talked about it. These two offenses need something to kind of jar them loose. A big play. We had the big play run by Hall. But other than that, really haven't been many explosive plays in the game. The defenses have really kind of controlled the point scenario. Both teams have been able to move it. Just can't get any points on the board. So for some play action, maybe somebody take a shot down the field.
Second and 19 for the Panthers, leading 7-3. in the 22nd all-time meeting between the programs. They'll go up the middle with Hall. He's got the big run today. The only touchdown so far in our game, Dave, 79 yards for Hall in the first quarter.
Yeah, just a breakdown up front. They caught Duke in a pressure look and able to crease him and nobody home in the middle of the field for the long run. Really the only mistake Duke's made defensively. Give Pitt credit, they haven't made the big mistake that's allowed Duke to get on the board. With
Pittsburgh,
a touchdown.
Yep, Pittsburgh has won the last two meetings between the teams, including last year at home. 56-14. It is now third and 15 for the Panthers. DiNucci throwing on the run inaccurately. And that above the head of Arujo Lopes and out of bounds and incomplete.
Yeah, really tough on a play caller, on a quarterback, on third and long when they're going to drop eight off into coverage. DiNucci just couldn't find anybody home and minimize the damage and fired the ball out of bounds.
So Ramming waits for the punt from Winslow with 9:26 to go in the third quarter. Ramming standing at his 25-yard line. Fair catch, and it's made successfully at the 31 by Ramming.
It's been a defensive battle so far. Daniel Jones going to get his opportunity in the second half. Let's see if Duke can get something going on offense.
Mike and I are both veterans, both served in the Navy.
We bought our first home together in 2010.
His family had used another insurance product, but I was like, well, I've had USAA for a while. Why don't we call and check the rates?
It was an instant savings, and I should have changed a long time ago.
Discover Card.
I'm not a customer, but I'm calling about that credit scorecard.
Give it?
Sure, it's free for everyone.
Oh, well, that's nice.
And checking your score won't hurt your credit.
Oh!
I'm so proud of you.
Well, thank you.
Free at discover.com/creditscorecard, even if you're not a customer.
ACC football is being brought to you by New York Life. With the right guidance, everyone can be good at life. By Coyote Tractor. By Hardee's. And by your local Toyota dealers. Toyota, let's go places.
The Duke Gardens, a 1935 gift from Sarah P. Duke, the widow of the university founder, Benjamin N. Duke. Our first and 10 line presented by Cookout, serving fresh char-grilled hamburgers and 40 fancy milkshakes. Blue Devils on offense from the 31. Jones, deep down the middle of the field, a diving attempt, and it's incomplete. Chris Taylor, all out for that one, couldn't pull it in.
Well, Coach Spurrier will be proud of this one. It's a shot play. You got Taylor down the pipe, little fake to the outside with the throw, and then try to pump it down the middle to Taylor, and just off his hands. Pretty well thrown ball there.
Quentin Harris has committed quarterback for Duke. On second and 10, flips it to Ramming. Turns the edge, Ramming, forcing his way past the 40 and up near the 42-yard line. 12 yards and a first down for Ramming.
Let's take a look at this blocking on the perimeter this time. Receivers out in front, get good block. Lloyd, number 5, gets a key block, and Ramming hits that little crease back into the inside.
Daniel Jones resumes his obligations at quarterback after one down for Quentin Harris. Jones, wide open man, middle of the field, Sean Wilson. And Wilson takes it to the end zone for Duke.
Tom, we talked about off the top, who are the best players on the team for Duke? And it's these two running backs, Sean Wilson, right through the middle on a busted coverage by Pitt. Wilson and Brown have been the key guys to try to get this Duke offense going.
Dave, that was 58 yards, the touchdown for Wilson.
Took a shot to start the drive. Got the reverse to Ramey. Now get it to Wilson. It's Duke with a three-point lead.
Apple CarPlay. I know you can feel the movement. Four distinct drive modes. Test drive one at your Acura dealer today. This is the new 2018 Acura TLX. Yeah.
Visit your local Tri-Acura dealer for attractive offers on the TLX.
Boy, it's your time.
You are Timac, the last dragon. You got the glow.
I think you ought to meet with this director.
I don't think there's anything in that damn contract about having dinner with Hollywood whack dudes.
You gotta go, Floyd.
Woo-wee! These people are seriously papered up.
Is it ever okay for a white person to use the N-word?
White Famous, new series Sundays at 10, only on Showtime. Start your free trial.
Has taken the lead, 58 yards. Daniel Jones to Sean Wilson. Third career receiving TD for the senior Sean Wilson from Charlotte, North Carolina. Maddox from the four. Upended at the 20-yard line. 16 yards on the return for Maddox.
Now let's take a look at this. Watch the two linebackers right here. They're both going to sprint out. Now one's got to make sure they pay attention to the back, so one's got to be back in the middle of the field. Nobody pays attention to Wilson. Give Zach Roper a ton of credit. This is a third quarter call, so they've seen something going on in pitch coverage that gave them the opportunity to slip Wilson right through the middle of the field. Unbelievable job by Wilson on the play.
That leads us, Dave, to our cookout fast fact.
They got a score. 36 plays. That's good. Eaton clock. Now I got to finish with points.
Panthers throw it on first down. Duke able to stop that play with Jordan Hayes. Arujo Lopes taken down.
Hayes has made a number of these plays out in space from that safety spot. We talk about the Cheetah Coalition. Chuck, when you talk about these five guys in the secondary, they're kind of interchangeable, kind of linebackers type slash safeties. Another play by Hayes.
Yeah, that's the kind of guys they like. They have guys who can be in coverage, hold, come down and will hit you. All these guys are versatile enough to play all these positions in this defense.
Arujo Lopes.
Tom, again, it's the Cheetahs. Start, look at these two guys come up. This one, Saxon, comes up and makes the play, number 21. But outside of him is Hayes. There's no place to go. You see McDuffie in there. Here they come down. That's the coalition of Cheetahs. That's what they call themselves, the Cheetahs. Those guys in the back end, they run and hunt as a pack. And they've got a lot of hats of football there.
Pittsburgh 5 of 12 on third down, this third and long. Third and 10 for the Panthers from their own 20-yard line. Quarterback is Ben DiNucci. Edges start to bend. He lets it go. It's complete. Maurice French, first down. Panthers out past the 35-yard line.
Boy, just a poor job on the outside by Gilbert. You cannot allow the receiver to turn to the outside. Keep your leverage outside. He drives to the inside. There's nobody out there on the outside to help you out. If you keep your outside leverage, he's got to turn back to the inside. That's where all your help is coming from. Just a poor decision by Gilbert on the outside and a big play by Pitt on third and long.
17 yards, DiNucci to Maurice French, the sophomore from New Brunswick, New Jersey. Fresh set of downs for the Panthers for their own 37. Whitehead. Joe Giles Harris is number 44, a loss of two.
Now we talked to Joe Giles Harris yesterday. We asked him, okay, what happens when number 9 comes in the game for Pitt? And he says, our ears perk up because they normally like to give him the ball when he's in the game. We're taught to seek and destroy if 9 touches the football. Well, say hello to the sophomore linebacker.
Joe Giles Harris, sophomore from Nyack, New York, leading tackler on this Duke defense. DiNucci spins it. Weah tried to go up with one hand. Incomplete. Fields back defensively, and we go back to Charlotte.
Our Hardee's update takes us to Doak Campbell, where Louisville's put up two more.
Our redshirt freshman, Day Williams, first game back after knee injury, 25-yard touchdown run, widening the gap over the Seminoles.
28-14, Louisville with a minute to go in the third.
Wow, those Panthers, a surprise in my book. I thought Louisville, obviously very good offensively with Lamar, but they are playing better defensively today than they did against BC a week ago.
Yeah, that loss dropped their record to 1-3 in the ACC, but trying to go on the road and win at Florida State. DiNucci got out of the pocket, but Ben Humphreys was the first one to initiate contact. 3 yards for DiNucci, and it's fourth down.
Good play by that Duke defense, again, to force a third and long and then rally up and make the tackle. Didn't do that the prior third down, but this time they get it done. We got two effective return guys in this game. Neither one of them have gotten loose yet, but T.J. Ramming standing deep, Tom. This guy can take it to the house.
Winslow, the punter for Pittsburgh.
Offside defense, number 32, 5 yard penalty, fourth down.
Well, remember early in the game, Duke came close to blocking a punt, and I think they can get one, but you got to stay onside. And now Coach Cutcliffe yelling out there, can't be offside again or it's going to be a first down. Got to pay attention to the ball.
Ramming deep for Duke. Standing at his 16-yard line. Ramming has to backtrack inside the five. Breaks one tackle. Nosedives to the 14-yard line. There's a flag thrown just behind the play. David Epperly, our referee.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 16 of the return team, half a distance to the goal, first down, timeout.
So the penalty against Duke after the 53-yard punt. And we'll be back after a word from your local ACC station.
Introducing new Degree Ultra Clear Black Plus White. Saves your white clothes from yellow stains and your black clothes from white marks. Still with 48-hour sweat protection. New Degree Ultra Clear Black Plus White. It won't let you down.
Heineken has served in 192 countries. It's world famous. Like me.
Come here. Look.
It happens all the time.
He's ready.
Oh. I'm sorry, you're back there. Yeah, the movies.
Enjoyed in 192 countries. There's more behind the star.
Hey fans, the ACC VR app now loaded with 360 videos from your favorite football stadiums, courtesy of Haviland. Take you right on the field, Dave, and into the locker room. You run down the hill at Memorial Stadium. It's virtual reality at its best, and you get the taste of ACC football.
Some of the cool moments in the ACC. We're going to get a chance to do one next week in prime time as we see Inner Sandman as the Hokies hit the field at Lane Stadium. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Enter those sweepstakes at accsweeps.havilandpromotions.com. Flag comes out. There was a flag as Jordan Whitehead made the catch of the interception. But again, there is a flag.
Like Hamlin, a little collision with Hamlin there in the slot.
Holding on the defense. 10-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Well, good job of heating up the quarterback. Good pressure forces Jones's hand. He lets it go before he really wants to. And you see the hold there, number three. That's Hamlin holding on as Bracy, the freshman, tries to go down the middle field. How about the catch by Whitehead? Spectacular grab.
Quentin Harris has committed the game day for Duke at quarterback. Hand off to Britton Brown, redshirt freshman from Canton, Georgia. And let's go down to DJ Shockley Hurd around the cooler. Gatorade. DJ?
Fellas, we've talked a lot about Jordan Whitehead today, and we got a chance to talk to defensive coordinator Josh Conklin about sharing Jordan Whitehead throughout the entire game. He said he tries to manage his reps in practice, also in the game. It's starting to get a little bit hot out here right now, but the thing about it is when he comes off the sideline, he never goes to the defense to check what they're doing or what the
checked his, he goes straight to the offense, and that's going to be something to watch this afternoon, especially in the second half as it gets a little bit hotter.
On second down, Britton Brown to the 20-yard line.
I think he's doing okay, Shock. He just tracked one down like a center fielder, made a Willie Mays catch for interception. Now got overturned because of a holding penalty, but I think Whitehead's okay right now. Boy, what a player he is. Think about that, to be able to play both sides of the field, grasp what you're doing on offense, certainly be the quarterback of the secondary defensively. Not a lot of guys can make that happen and manage that week to week.
Duke, 3 for 6. Third down conversions. Daniel Jones looking to his right. Deflected away. Scott Bracey was the intended receiver. Avante Maddox got a piece of it and deflected it. Now there is a Pitt player down.
Looks like Avante Maddox.
Yeah, it was Maddox who was on coverage against Bracey down on that sideline.
Boy, makes a heck of a play. High points the ball on the throw to the big receiver, Bracey, 6'2", 210-pound receiver. Let's see if we can take a look here. Bump and run coverage in a perfect position. Goes up, knocks the ball down. Well, it looks like Bracey's knee came up.
It's like
and made contact.
It's like a.
We can take a look here. Does his arm get caught? I can't tell from that.
You see Coach Narduzzi in the background rushing to the aid of Avante Maddox.
Well, I think he does. I think the right arm gets pinned underneath Bracey, and that's actually the coach dragging him off the field.
Right.
I think it's right arm as he's coming down. I think that shot we had from the end zone guy might be a better shot of it. We want to look at it.
Avante Maddox, Dave, is a senior from Detroit, Michigan. 6 career interceptions, and he's taken 2 back for touchdowns.
See, the right arm, it just came down at an awkward angle. Shock, did you get a look at that?
Yeah, I actually was standing right here by the Gatorade cooler when it happened, and I turned around, and immediately they went to grab for his right forearm area. So they're checking that right forearm elbow area right now.
Yeah, Shock, I think his arm, it doesn't get pinned. It actually strikes Bracey's leg as he's coming down. But you hope Avante Maddox has been an amazing player. This is his 37th start as a Pitt Panther. 44 games he's played. And some of his teammates taking a knee and saying a prayer for Avante Maddox. 5 tackles today. He's got a sack, broken up a couple of passes.
Maddox up and walking. DJ, you have more on his status?
Yeah, eventually he's walking over now, and he's real ginger with that right arm and the right. It's really more of a lower arm.
Well, let's hope that Monte Maddox is okay.
So, punting situation for Duke. Arujo Lopes will field this punt. Have to backtrack a little bit now inside the 30. To his left, Arujo Lopes up close to midfield and pulled down. It's a 51-yard punt. The return of 12 from Arujo Lopes. The Top 25 is brought to you by Progressive. AP Top 25 has 4 ACC teams there.
Yeah, Miami have been a big game against Syracuse. Syracuse is the team that knocked Clemson from number 2 down to number 7. So that'll be an interesting matchup. Clemson and NC State go head-to-head here in a few weeks. They both have a bye this week. Virginia Tech is kind of lurking, Tom. Virginia Tech kind of laying in the weeds there, waiting for their opportunity.
Taking on North Carolina today at home. We will be at Lane Stadium next weekday. Prime time. It's a night game as we'll watch these Blue Devils go on the road to take on Virginia Tech. That is our ACC Network Game of the Week presented by Mellow Mushroom next Saturday from Blacksburg, Virginia.
Yeah, I look forward to watching you gnaw on a turkey leg while Inner Sandman is taking place. That'll be a lot of fun up there.
That will be a priority when we head to Blacksburg. Always an incredible setting for college football. We turn it up a few notches. We're taking it up a notch next week in Blacksburg at Lane Stadium.
And Tom, another short field opportunity for this Pitt offense. Again, they've not handled these opportunities very well.
Second down for the Panthers. They go right side and Davis. Olesen, Hall, and Davis Day, the three backs primarily used by the Pittsburgh offense.
Now, Lakeland, Florida native is A.J. Davis, almost 5,400 yards career rushing in high school at Lakeland High School for A.J. Davis. They were really excited about this freshman.
So third and short now for Pittsburgh. 6 of 14 in this situation in the ballgame. Panthers led 7-3 at halftime. Duke has the score in this half. A Sean Wilson TD reception. They'll slam it into the line with Davis. Not sure about that one, Dave Archer.
No, he had Quadre Olesen in front of him at the fullback spot. Trying to lead. Number 37 got a lead up on the block right there. Kind of got a stalemate, but a good job by Duke at the point of attack. And force a fourth down play right here. I think you got to lean when you look at where you're going to go. I think you go right back to the interior. The strength of this offense is their offensive line and the downhill running attack.
They've already made it once today, Dave.
Yeah, the freshman still in the game.
Fourth and one for Pittsburgh. Up the middle. Look at the surge by Duke and Joe Giles Harris.
Boy, a textbook play by the sophomore linebacker.
No gain on the play, and the Blue Devils take over on downs.
Number 44, Joe Giles Harris, going to fill right there, head-to-head with the freshman. And Duke turns Pitt away again at midfield. Boy, these short field opportunities come back to haunt you. You see Jim Knowles, the defensive coordinator, he loves this group he has on defense. They're one of the best in the country. They showed it right there. And now a short field situation for Duke on offense.
It's the best starting field position of the game for the Blue Devils. Jones looking left, trying to put some touch on it. Nearly intercepted, looking for Daniel Helm. Jordan Whitehead was back there with Helm.
Helm made a defensive play there, or Whitehead's going to come up with an interception. Really well played by Jordan Whitehead, the free safety. Tried to get him with a little wheel route. And Jordan Whitehead having none of it. Doc Shock talked about his ability, his versatility. They can play on offense, but he's an outstanding safety man.
Jones with the time to deliver. Hits his man at the 40. It's a first down, and it's Sean Wilson again. 18 yards for Duke.
Well, I love what Zach Roper's done now. He realizes his backs are a mismatch. Opportunity to get the back on the linebacker, Brightwell. Outstanding throw from Jones in the pocket. And Wilson touches Pitt again down through the middle of the field.
Just 45 seconds to go in the third quarter. Duke with a 10-7 lead. First down from the 39 of Pittsburgh. Jones with a fake. Now going deep. Ramming running under it. Makes the catch. Touchdown, T.J. Ramming.
T.J. Ramming, big play receiver for Duke. Came in the leading receiver on the year. And he got in behind the Pitt defense after a really good play fake by Daniel Jones. And Ramming is finally in the end zone for the year.
Second TD toss of the quarter for Daniel Jones. Parker adds the extra point with 28 seconds to go in the third. It's Jones to Ramming, and the Blue Devils are in the end zone.
Flash play fake, throws the safety. And we just talked about Jordan Whitehead, outstanding safety man. He got caught peeking in the backfield. And a quick play fake to Wilson, and Ramming with the great speed in behind. Got a time chance to talk to TJ's brother who's here watching him. He said he was going to get in the end zone today. I said, hey, I haven't seen TJ in the end zone much. In fact, that's only his fourth career touchdown as a Duke Blue Devil. He's been such a great receiver all over the years. Let's take a look at what happens in the secondary. These two guys right here, that's Whitehead right there. He gets caught peeking in the backfield on the play fake. One step forward, and that's too many. With ramming with the great speed is in behind, and an excellent throw from Daniel Jones.
39 yards on the play. Three plays, 57 yards, just 48 seconds. Daniel Jones to TJ ramming. Jones now 7 of 16, 174 yards passing, and a couple of TDs, both coming in the third quarter for Daniel Jones. Henderson out of that Pitt end zone. Stop cold, short of the 10, 8 yards on the return for Henderson. Let's go to our Charlotte studio.
Let's head back to Doak Campbell Stadium for our Hardee's update.
I've been calling for the Noles to run the ball more. They've been doing a good job. But Jacquez Patrick fumbles, but his boy Naquan Murray jumps on it right there to give the Noles a 7-point deficit.
Yeah, 28-21, 12 minutes to play in the fourth.
Well, you kind of had to figure that that was going to be a pretty good game by those two teams down. I know Florida State trying to get back a little bit from what happened to them last year when they were up at Papa John's in Louisville.
Pittsburgh, first down, inside their own 10. Hall breaks free. Darrin Hall trying to outdistance the defenders. The sprint to the end zone. Darrin Hall beats them all. Touchdown, Pittsburgh.
Boy, David Cutcliffe just chomping on that headset as he's talking to Jim Knowles. Again, Duke gets caught in a pressure look where linebackers are stepping inside. Overrun by McDuffie, the safety, number 9. And Hall with the speed. Once he creases it, another long touchdown.
Dave, that one went for 92 yards. So Hall with rushing touchdowns of 79 yards in the first quarter. 92 late in the third. Darrin Hall, the junior from Youngstown, Ohio.
Tom, we take a look at the all 22 so we can see what's going on. The two linebackers right here are both going to step in, and McDuffie, the safety, is going to overrun the play. McDuffie's got to be the guy that fills that hole with the linebacker stepping inside, and he's not in the right position. And then Hall's proven now twice that he's got great speed once he gets in the open field. And he shoves another one in the end zone, another huge run. You're aggressive on defense. You kind of live by the sword, die by the sword. And that was a defensive look where the two linebackers had stepped inside, were protecting a gap, and they're expecting that safety to be in behind as that utility guy, and he was not there.
Dave, the Panthers have been playing football at the collegiate level for 128 years. You just saw the longest touchdown run in the history of Pittsburgh Panther football.
Well, the more alarming thing is that number 33 ran the football for Pitt back in the day. So, boy, that's a bit surprising. I did not know that with Tony Dorsett as a guy that carried the ball for him.
Panthers started playing football in 1890. They were known as the Western University of Pennsylvania. Second rushing TD of a considerable distance from Darrin Hall. Sean Wilson bounces off a couple of Panthers. He drags them into Pitt territory. Wilson on the final play of the quarter with a big return for Duke. Three yards on the return by Wilson. Duke will have the football in the fourth when we come back. 17-14, Blue Devils.
Dave. We are the TV doctors of America, and we may not know much about medicine, but we know a lot about drama.
From scandalous romance
to ridiculous plot twists.
Son?
Dad.
We also know you can avoid drama by getting an annual checkup.
So we're partnering with Cigna to remind you to go see a real doctor.
Go, know, and take control of your health.
It could save your life.
Doctor poses.
Dad.
Cigna, together all the way.
Now your favorite movies and shows can go all the weird places you go and they'll never judge you.
Who's your service provider?
DirecTV.
You have DirecTV.
With the Xfinity Stream app, you can download everything on your DVR anywhere.
so you can watch offline.
Wow.
Even on a plane?
Even on a plane.
Anything on your DVR, anything on demand, you can download it onto the device.
This is sweet.
So how do you feel about DirecTV?
I think it's time for change.
85% of people prefer Xfinity X1 to their current TV experience. Switch to Xfinity for $89.99 a month for 2 full years. Don't wait. Click today.
14 points in the third for Duke. Couple of TD passes. And Darrin Hall going the distance for the touchdown in the third. 17-14, our first and 10 line, brought to you by Cookout, serving fresh char-grilled hamburgers and 40 fancy milkshakes.
Wow, all of a sudden, Tom, got some offense.
How much fun has this second half been so far, that third quarter? Some exciting plays. Duke wants another one. Down the seam. Incomplete as Dane Jackson tried to make a one-handed interception. Scott Bracey was the intended receiver. Our third quarter stats brought to you by the North Carolina Education Lottery, celebrating 11 years, over $5 billion raised for education. To learn more, visit nclottery.com.
They get touchdown drives that add up to a minute and 58 seconds. A couple of TD drives, so Quinn's quick strike here in the third quarter after the two defenses owned it.
We've seen a lot of Quentin Harris today. He's back out there on a design quarterback run. Doesn't get much. In fact, he lost one.
Good recognition by, they know when Harris comes in the game, doesn't throw the football. This is a run scenario when he comes in, and Zeiss, the linebacker, they just make form an eight-man front, and Zeiss comes off the edge to make the play.
Don't forget Victory Formation, our post-game show on the ACC.com. Katie, Tommy, Stan from our Charlotte studio. 3 of 7 on third down for Duke. This is third and long, third and 11. Whistles halt the play. Timeout is called. Pittsburgh Panthers. Third and 11 coming up. We'll see what Pat Narduzzi dials up defensively when we come back to Durham.
Kyle.
HBO Now.
You think we can get to the moon?
We're already there.
Get unlimited access to more of the biggest and latest hit movies before any other streaming service.
Really?
Yes.
Plus, watch every episode of every season of the most talked about shows. With big premieres streaming the same time as they air on TV. On all of your devices. HBO Now. Stream free for 1 month. No cable package required.
When you look at the Mercedes-Benz GLC, with its high-tech cameras and radar, contemporary cockpit, 360-degree network of driver assist technologies, and sporty performance. What's most impressive about the GLC? All depends on your point of view. The 2018 GLC, starting at $40,050. Mercedes-Benz, the best or nothing.
By Coke. And by Mellow Mushroom, out of this world pizza.
Just a perfect afternoon on Duke University campus here in Durham, North Carolina, as we go down to DJ.
Fellas, before the fourth quarter started, Pat Narduzzi had his whole team around him, and he emphasized, we stressed all week long, we must finish games. And he said, we have a great opportunity to do it right now on the road. Finish the game now.
Yeah, Shock had to burn a timeout right there for this third and long situation. Hope that didn't come back to haunt him.
From the 45-yard line, Daniel Jones. Goes the pass, incomplete. Near the 35 to Daniel Helm. Salim Brightwell defensively for Pitt.
Well, you got to have strong hands in the tight end position. Brightwell's in a good spot. Swats with the left hand. Helm can't hang on right at the sticks. And Pitt gets off the field on third down. Well thrown ball. Got to reach and pluck that ball out of the air. Helm could not hang on. Give Brightwell the credit. He swatted it out of there.
Henderson, the deep man, standing at his 10. It's a low liner. He's going to watch it bounce at the 11 and go out of bounds. And they will mark it right around the 5-yard line. Fans, picture yourself with the 2017 Dr. Pepper ACC Football Championship. Mellow Mushroom giving you the opportunity to be there. Visit mellowmushroom.com/ACC to enter for your chance to win the Mellow Mushroom VIP sweepstakes. Now to DJ.
We saw the injury by Avante Maddox. You can see him sitting on the sideline. He has a sling on. He has an ice bag attached to their right forearm. And he tried to get him to leave the sideline a couple times, but it looked like he wants to stay there and be there for his teammates.
Well, you can tell he's still in pain, too, Shock, as we're looking at him on the bench. He's got that elbow sleeve on and he's cradled it in his lap. Hate to see that for the senior.
Worst starting field position of the game for the Panthers. And now Darrin Hall touches the football, and every time he does, don't take your eyes off him. A run of 79 yards in the first quarter for a touchdown, 92 yards in the third quarter for a TD for Darrin Hall.
Yeah, a little very unsung coming into the game, the Youngstown, Ohio native Darrin Hall. Talked about different guys they've used at back with at the running back position. Hall has settled in to be that number one guy, and he has been a big timer today.
Hall averaging just over 15 yards rushing per game coming into today, Dave. He's got 214, trying to add to the total up near the 15-yard line.
Yeah, and give that offensive line credit, Tom, as they pound one out over the 15 for a first down. And that's what you're looking to do as an offense here. You want to at least get this out of here. You're still down 3 points, even with Hall's heroics running the football. So you got to try to move it. But that big offensive line trying to take over the line of scrimmage.
Panthers trying to snap a two-game losing streak. They lost last Saturday against NC State at home, 35-17. The first win for NC State in five trips to Pittsburgh. Again, 35-17 was the final. Hall on the carry. Back to the studio with Katie.
Let's check into Tallahassee for another Hardee's update.
Freshman Florida State quarterback James Blackman going toe-to-toe Lamar Jackson. Naquan Murray, 20-yard touchdown catch for the Seminoles.
28-28 in the fourth quarter with just under nine to play.
Well, think about the, just for instance, to think about next year. How about the quarterback battle that's going to go on in Tallahassee with DeMonde Francois and Blackman, how he's starting to play. That's going to be a heck of a battle to watch next spring.
12:15 to go in regulation. Jester Weah makes the catch beyond the 35. And fights his way to the 40. Saxton took him down. And there's Jester Weah, a dangerous receiver, 25 yards on the catch.
Big physical receiver at 6'2", 210. You got the corner that's going to jam and just kind of lose ground. He gets in that little hole between the safety and the corner. And an excellent throw that time by DiNucci, right on the money, high pointed it so the big receiver could go up and get it.
First catch of the game for Weah, who had seven catches for 106 yards last week against NC State. The fourth time in his career over 100 yards receiving in a game. DiNucci. Deep. Struggle for the football. Who's got it? Right at the 10. It's Gilbert and Weah fighting for it. And they hit the football. The Now the Eagles are up on the play, down at the 10, and the indication we saw is that it was a completion to Weah.
Well, it's a dueling catch is what it is, Tom. This is a ball that I think is initially picked off by Gilbert, but as they go to the ground, Weah gets in there and grabs the football.
Simultaneous possession, which goes to the offense, first down.
49 yards on the catch by Weah, who has come alive.
Now watch, Gilbert's going to get the ball first, but Weah has the presence of mind, he pulls at the football, and now it's a dueling catch before the official can get in. Give Gilbert credit, he's got the football when it high points. You get a timeout by Duke. I know they're going to want to, all these plays are reviewed.
There will be an official review. While they start that, we'll take a timeout. We'll come back, see what the story is here in Durham.
What day?
So how's that medical thing going?
Well, the doctor said...
Sorry, what?
I said the doctor told...
Excusez-moi?
The doctor said...
No more public pools for me!
Snap into a Slim Jim!
Hello, the goddess of death has invaded Asgard. So we're putting together a team to stop her.
A team? Has it got a name?
Revengers.
Revengers?
I mean, we don't have to have a name. PG-13, November 3rd.
Back at Duke with a 17-14 lead for Duke. That's Gilbert the corner, Weah, and there's Darrell Revis. He is the cousin of Gilbert the corner. Now let's take a look here. Gilbert reaches up with the right hand, pulls it into the body. He's got it. Now on the ground, And now Weah comes in and wrestles himself into a simultaneous catch situation. Frankly, I think that's an interception by Mark Gilbert. But a good job by Weah to realize that he's going to get the call if it's a simultaneous catch.
Not a reviewable play officially, Dave. So the call on the field, as Dave mentioned, for the simultaneous catch stays with Pittsburgh. That was 49 yards on the play. So Jester Weah has made two big catches on this drive, his first two of the football game. Hall to his left, inside the five. They drag him down 7 yards. Sexton the tackle.
Well, defensively for Duke now, as aggressive as you are with your linebackers, this, we talked about the cheetahs, these safeties are going to have to tackle well because they're getting one-on-one opportunities with Hall. He's finding a way to get through that second level, and they're going to have to make some plays. But the Duke defense has been pretty stingy, Tom. Only giving up 19 points a game coming in.
Panthers 0-1 in the red zone today from the 5. Hall makes a move to his right, and he steps right in the end zone. Third rushing touchdown of the game, Darrin Hall. This one from 4 yards out.
Perfect call by Jim Knowles. He's got 21 sacks in right there. I'm sorry, Hayes, 13, is in the backfield on the blitz, and he just runs right by Hall. He has the call. Saxon coming on one side, Hayes on the other. The two safeties coming on the blitz. And Hayes just ran right by Hall as he stepped inside of him for the touchdown.
Third rushing touchdown of the game for Hall, his fourth of the season.
And a big-time play by Jester Weah sets up the opportunity. And who's been the star? Darrin Hall shoves another one in the end zone.
Hey. I think we've hit a new stage in our relationship. Will you join my Wi-Fi?
Yes!
This is all moving so fast.
Find your awesome with Xfinity XFi.
DirecTV has been rated number one in customer satisfaction over cable for 17 years running. But some people still like cable, just like some people like banging their head on a low ceiling. Switch to number one rated customer satisfaction over cable. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
You're watching ACC football presented by Mellow Mushroom. Here's our drive summary brought to you by LendingTree. Dave, when banks compete, you win.
Hey, take a look at this scoring drive. How about that one? That's their second drive in the game that's been 90 plus. Of course, one came on one play, the Hall touchdown, but two touchdown drives of 90 plus yards for Pitt today.
Kickoff sails into the end zone. In fact, that drive we just showed you, the first drive for a touchdown in the game by either team that lasted more than a minute. Tickets to the 2017 Dr. Pepper ACC Championship on sale now. Visit Ticketmaster.com to purchase today. Also, be sure to tag your game day photos this season with hashtag ACCFans for a chance to be featured in an ACC commercial.
An opportunity now for Duke as we take a look at what's coming up next week.
What do we got, Dave?
Next week, the noon game is Louisville and Wake Forest. And then, of course, prime time. This Duke team travels to Lane Stadium to take on the 14th-ranked Hokies of Virginia Tech.
Evan Leppler, Takeo Spikes, Amanda Cool will be at Wake Forest for the Cards. Cards and Demon Deke. So we'll be at Virginia Tech. Tom Wormy, Dave Archer, DJ Shockley on the sidelines. Ramming. Up to the 45, TJ Ramming.
Well, I think Zach Roper's done a nice job of getting his playmakers the ball here, especially in the second half. Ramming, what a nice move to get to the inside. The defender waiting on him. Zeiss, the linebacker. Little inside-out move and depth inside on that little angle route. And a good job of the quarterback being on the same page. DJ Ramming stepping up here in the second half.
Fifth catch for Ramming. That one went for 22 yards. Five receiver look for Duke on first down. Jones at midfield. Chris Taylor goes out of bounds. It's another first down at the 41-yard line of Pittsburgh, and that one was 12 yards worth.
They've really kind of loosened up their look now, playing a lot of empty set, spreading Pitt out across the field, and Daniel Jones is dealing. No safety in the middle of the field back here.
Keeping that five receiver set for the Blue Devils. Jones picks out a man. It's ramming. He's got some real estate. The high step at the 24. Now the ball came out at the end. The officials are saying it was dead at the 19 as Pinnock made the tackle. 22 yards, TJ Ramming.
Well, a lot of cushion for Ramming. Ramming's right here. Look where the defender is. He's just going to go to the out route. Jones sees that there's nobody covering him. And then a good block at the top when Ramming caught the ball to get him up the field.
Another first down for Duke. Into the red zone, over the middle, incomplete. Bracey couldn't hang on. Redshirt freshman from Richmond, Virginia.
Yeah, you got to have those, though, Tom. This is a good throw by Jones right on the money. You know the defender's coming. Garner the safety. Two freshmen there going head-to-head. Bracey and Garner.
Jones. A low pass, incomplete. Keaston Fuller.
Yeah, dropping the football there. Now Jones is a little bit in a panic because his eyes aren't on the field. As he's trying to catch it and look at the coverage. Now he's got to catch it. He realizes pressure's coming off the edge. Probably didn't really seat the ball in his hand. Certainly didn't grab the threads on the football there and shot it behind now. So an opportunity now here. Now a third down opportunity, long. Up two for Pitt to win in the red zone.
3 for 8 on third down. 1 for 1 in the red zone for Duke. They had a field goal earlier in the game. The blitz comes and Jones is sacked at Stane Jackson.
Yeah, that's just a young quarterback, Tom, that doesn't recognize the corner fire. He's got a guy open that's available right where the corner comes from, but he just doesn't see it. Going to get blitz off his left side. See, his eyes are looking right all the way. He never sees Dane Jackson coming off that left edge. And he had people available on a side adjustment.
There's a loss of 13 on the play, and a timeout is called by the Pittsburgh Panthers. So the sack for Dane Jackson. And now with 8:54 to go in the fourth, there's a timeout by Pittsburgh. Jones went out there for fourth down. We'll see what happens.
See the conversation. Here's Jackson. He's going to come off the edge. The receiver's just going to slow play it. There's your throw right there. Watch it develop. The safety can't get over. There's a throw for him. He just doesn't see it because his eyes never look to that side of the field. As a quarterback, a young guy, you got to see whether the safety's trying to cheat over. If he's cheating over, you got to kind of smell something off that weak side. Corner came off the backside. He never saw it.
Coming up next Saturday, two ACC Network games presented by Mellow Mushroom. At noon, the Heisman Trophy winner from a year ago, Lamar Jackson, leads Louisville against Wake Forest. Then at 7, that's right, 7 p.m., Daniel Jones, the Duke Blue Devils, headed to Blacksburg to take on Cam Phillips and number 14, Virginia Tech. Double duty for the ACC Blitz, powered by Ram Trucks. Katie, Tommy, and Stan on the air at noon. Back again at 7. Go to the ACC.com for more details. Jones throws it inside the 10. Underthrown, but a flag comes out. There are two of them.
Wow, just a bad mistake. They just got through making the play. Dane Jackson makes the play, gives
pass
it back.
Interference. Defense. Number 11. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
He just doesn't continue to run. See, he squatted down right there, really slow to turn his hips when he saw the ball in the air and just was in a bad position. Now he can't locate the football, and it's a good call. The underthrow, no chance to come back and catch the football. Just a poor technique that time by Jackson after making a huge play the play before.
The receiver was Aaron Young. First and 10, Duke. Jones sends it back the other way to Wilson. He can't hang on. Might have heard some oncoming traffic.
Yeah, and you got to be accurate with these throws, Tom. When you've got a receiver that's coming back in traffic, that ball's got to be down around the bottom of his numbers. That can't be up over his head where he's got to pull his arms down and then try to make somebody miss. So not a good throw by Daniel Jones there.
10 of 24, 230 yards passing for Jones and a couple of TDs, both in the third quarter. Lets this one go. Wilson on the edge, and he's wrangled down and thrown out of bounds.
Adowu does a great job here at the linebacker spot, Tom. And just not a very good block on the perimeter. Trying to get their playmakers the ball. I think Zach Roper's done a great job of that, getting ramming the ball. Here's Wilson out in space. Just a gut job by Adowu, the leading tackler for the Panthers, to get him out of bounds.
Third and 11 from the 18 of Pittsburgh.
Now they've hurt Pitt in the middle of the field. Something on a crossing route. The sideline, Pitt's been able to use the sideline as an extra defender.
Jones, incomplete. Just a little toss over the middle to help.
Yeah, what they're trying to do, they made a fake to the outside to pull defenders out, and they tried to leak the tight end right back over the ball. Helm, the tight end, kind of slow plays it right here, and now he's going to release right in the middle. And as it turned out, they didn't get any pass rush. Watts, Amir Watts, the middle, the nose tackle, didn't even rush, and he almost intercepted it.
Austin Parker is on to the attempt at the field goal. He's already made one in the second quarter from 25 yards away. This from 36 for Parker. It is no good. Wide to the right, Austin Parker. The miss. And the Panthers will have it back. Also have the lead, 21-17 in the fourth. And we'll be back after a word from your local ACC station.
Wise man, I'm nervous about things I can't control affecting my good credit score.
I see you've planted an uncertainty tree.
Chop that thing down.
The clarity you seek lies within the CreditWise app from Capital One. CreditWise helps you
protect your credit.
And it's completely free for everyone.
It's free for everyone?
Do hawks use the stars to navigate?
I don't know.
Oh, I thought you did. I don't know either. Either way, it's free for everyone.
Cool.
What's in your wallet?
Coke Zero is now Coke Zero Sugar, with great Coke taste. Some people were excited to hear the news, some were skeptical. So we're not going to have the star of the show you're watching come out and say, "You'll love it." No special jingle written by this week's hottest pop star. No famous internet celebs who happen to be holding the label just so. Okay, maybe just one little pour shot. The only thing that will make you believe Coke Zero Sugar has great Coke taste is trying it yourself. Ice cold Coke Zero Sugar. Try one today.
It's a production of Raycom Sports. Here's a look at our Toyota game summary. For summaries of other ACC games, visit the Toyota Game Center on the ACC.com.
Hall and Ramming have both come up big for their respective teams. How about the season high, 310 yards on the ground and the time of possession? This is a Duke defense that came in 16th in the country, giving up only 108 yards on the ground, over 300 today for Pitt.
Seventh time Ramming has gone over 100 yards receiving in a ball game in his Duke career. Hall stumbles up to the 25. Katie, you've got a final from Tallahassee. Let's check in with you.
I do. Our Hardee's update takes us to Doak Campbell, where it was a mess for Florida State.
No, no, no. You do not run any type of read action, mesh point. James Blackman should have just handed off to Cam Akers there.
Blanton Creeky, a 34-yarder, sealed the deal for Louisville, 31-28 over Florida State.
Wow, what a game. Second straight week that the Cardinals have gone to the last seconds to decide their game day after the loss to Boston College. Henderson knocked down just beyond the 30, but he's got enough for a first down, 5 yards.
Duffy saved the play right there.
Here's a look at our Haviland defensive shield, David. Involves Duke against the run. Pretty good, except for today.
Yeah, I just talked about how they were 16th in the country, third in the ACC, 108 yards a game, and Pitt up over 300 yards rushing the football, and a couple of more runs there have extended this drive.
Check in with DJ.
One thing I noticed, guys, is in the first half, there were a lot of run blitzes for Duke defense. In the second half, they haven't done much of that because they got gashed so much in the first half with those run blitzes called.
Yeah, they like to be aggressive with those two linebackers, Shock, and I think they've been a little bit more reluctant to turn those two guys loose. And because it has put Hall or whoever's carrying the football one-on-one with that secondary, and the two big runs have come on those exact plays. The linebackers involved and tangled up in a gap, and the next thing you know, Hall's out the backside with nobody there.
Runs of 79 and 92 yards by Darrin Hall, the junior. Four touchdowns. That 92-yarder, a school record rush for a touchdown from scrimmage.
How about that? How about you put your name on the list above Tony Dorsett?
That is, it's quite a list in the lore of Pittsburgh football. Little trickery. Henderson. McDuffie tripped him up.
They put a lot of pressure. Coach Knowles puts a lot of pressure on these safeties to make plays. Now, they've made a number of them, but they've missed a couple. This time, McDuffie does an excellent job coming up from that safety spot and making the tackle. Huge third down play here for Duke.
6 of 15 in the game on third down for the Panthers. From their own 35-yard line and leading 21-17 against Duke. Danucci on third and six. Towards midfield and caught it to Rujo Lopes. Into Duke territory, down to the 45. First down, 20 yards on the play.
Yeah, they catch Duke in man coverage and just run the go route on the outside, and the slot receiver runs the out route versus an inside technique defender. This is a standard throw that you have in every playbook. And he was so open that the ball was thrown behind him, Rujo Lopes, and still made the catch. McDuffie way off on the coverage. Excellent call. And an opportunity for them to bleed more time off this clock, Tom.
Fourth catch for Arujo Lopes, who leads the team now with 36 catches on the season. That one went for 20 yards and a first down. Back to the ground with Hall. And he got bumped after 2 yards. Down to the turf, 99, Mike Ramsey.
Yeah, big Mike Ramsey, the leader of that defensive front. And he's got to be playing at a fever pitch right now because of the yards they've given up on the ground. Big-time player in that middle of this Duke defense.
Pat Narduzzi perfect as the Pitt head coach against Duke, 2-0. They've won the last two meetings. One here at Duke in the last meeting between the teams in Durham in 2015, 31-13, the win for the Panthers. Hall up the middle, trying to break free. Maybe a yard short of the first down marker as he got 7.
And you start thinking about, when do you burn your timeouts if you're Coach Cutcliffe? Here on third and short, you're not going to want to do it because the odds of them getting a first down here are pretty good. You want to be able to stop the clock on the next potential next three downs. So I think Coach Cutcliffe is going to hold on to his timeouts. His defense gets a stop here, he may burn a timeout.
But third,
he's hedging his bet a little bit here, Tom.
Third and one, Dave. Paul. First down, Panthers. McDuffie the tackle. 6 yards for Hall, who now has 22 carries for 256 yards and 3 TDs.
Darrin Hall, 5'11", 220, came in as a bit of an unknown, probably to the outside fan, probably not to Pitt fans, and certainly not to this Pitt coaching staff, as he's been the starter this season. Came in just with 108 yards on the season, averaging 3.5 yards a carry. But he has had a monster day, doing his best impression of James Conner right now.
James Conner, who ran for 3,733 yards in his Pittsburgh career.
Now that should be a timeout there from Coach Cut. He sure got it.
Loss of one on that play. The ACC Network would like to send condolences to family and friends of former Pitt tight end John Brown. John passed away yesterday at his Lower Burl residence. John was part of the most famous TD pass in Panther football history, a 33-yard catch from Dan Marino in the 82 Sugar Bowl that gave the Panthers a win over Georgia. John Brown was 58 years old.
Yeah, Tom, Dan Marino walked to the sideline, talked to Jackie Sherrill on a 4th-and-5 situation, and said, "We're not kicking a field goal. We're going to go win this game." And who did he pick out? He picked out John Brown right down the middle against man coverage. One of the great plays in Pitt football history. Brown hauled it in, and the rest was history as Pitt rolled on to a 24-20 win over Georgia in the Sugar Bowl. And boy, our sentiments and feelings and prayers go out to the John Brown family.
The Pittsburgh football family thinking about John Brown today and also trying to honor his memory with a victory on the road here at Duke. A close football game. Just 7-3 at halftime. Pat Narduzzi's team led. And now 21-17 on the strength of three TD rushes from Darrin Hall, who had three in his entire career, Dave, coming into this afternoon's action.
He has come up big when Coach Narduzzi is needing him the most.
10th play of this current drive for the Pittsburgh Panthers. Nothing there for Hall.
Looks like Cliff's going to hang on to a timeout now. Going to let this clock come down, make Pitt snap the football, and then burn his next timeout. Got one left.
This drive for Pittsburgh approaching 6 minutes of elapsed time on the clock. And don't forget, Victory Formation, our postgame show on the ACC.com. Tommy, Stan, and Katie from those Charlotte studios. Talk about that exciting finish between Louisville and Florida State and our exciting finish here in Durham.
Comes the pressure.
Third and long. That pass is incomplete. Looking for Arujo Lopes. Incomplete. Fourth down.
Looked like Joe Giles Harris is going to come right to the middle. Oh, take that back. Pressure through the little Hornbuckle. James Hornbuckle looped around, got right in the face of DiNucci there and threw it wide, and now you force a long field goal. Remember now, long field goals, potentially slower kicks. Duke looking for a block.
Kessman is 0 for 2 in the game, misses from 47 and 55 yards. This is from 50. Alex Kessman for the Panthers, and there's a flag on the field.
Duke, what's happening to Duke is the snapper is moving his head. And it's drawing Duke offside. That's happened on punts. And did it happen again here to the punt or the field goal block unit? It certainly looks like it.
Offside defense. 5-yard penalty. Still fourth down.
Now Duke's got to be very careful. Watch the head of the center. Watch him lift up and down. It's just that lift up in the air drew the movement interior by Duke's defense.
So from 45 yards away for Alex Kessman, the redshirt freshman. 0 for 2 in the game on field goal attempts. Kessman connects from 45 yards, plenty of leg. And he puts the Panthers up 24-17, 1:41 to go in regulation.
Well, it's a heck of a drive by Pitt to take that much time off and then end up with points. Excellent kick by Kessman and a really nice job by Coach Narduzzi's group to move the football and take time off.
Yeah, Dave, that drive chewed up 6 minutes and 19 seconds, culminating with the Kessman field goal.
And maybe head faked here a little bit of who he thought would be the star of the game. We talked about some other players, but Darrin Hall was not one of them, and we should have been paying attention. Number 22 has been a monster today. Two long touchdown runs, one of 79, one of 92, which puts him in the record books in Pitt football history, and a third rushing touchdown. He came in with three in his career. He's got three today. There's your Chevy player of the game.
Performance of the game brought to you by your local Chevy dealers. That's Hall, Dave. No question about it. You know, it's the second straight week we've seen an incredible effort from a running back. A.J. Dillon last week for Boston College. Over 270 yards rushing in Hall today. Wilson gains the 20. Out of bounds past the 25-yard line. They'll mark him out at the 27. And that's the amount of the return by Wilson.
Okay, you got a minute and a half if you're Duke. One timeout in your pocket. Knowing as a young quarterback, you got to remember that anything beyond the chain stops the clock. But there's got to be a sense of urgency. If you get the clock stop with a first down, got to be quickly on the ball. Get your team lined up. Have an idea of what potentially Zach Roper wants to get to. Remember, these are situations they work on virtually every day. Two-minute offense.
1:34 showing on the clock here at Wallace-Wade Stadium. It's been the home of Duke football since 1929. The Blue Devils have a drive. Ramming is open up near midfield. That's the way to start for the Blue Devils.
Ball still inbounds, though. Clock stop with the first down. Got to be on. Ramming's got nobody. Just going to run a corner route. Corner steps up to take away the short throw. Ramming open. Good job here by Daniel Jones to get back on the ball.
They got 22 yards on the previous play for the 49 for Duke. Jones comes to the other side of the field. It was a great attempt by Chris Taylor, defended by Dane Jackson, and incomplete.
It's been a good matchup all day long. Taylor and Jackson. Shock 2 minute. This is what you live for as a quarterback.
It is, and it's what makes these young guys great players. But the one thing is, you have to get these completions. You got to stay ahead of these chains, even on first and second down.
A couple of flags come out on this play.
Brightwell's going to be a call for grabbing TJ Ramming.
Pass interference. Defense. Number 39. First down.
Now this looks like a move you see in the ice skating rink here. Pair skating right there. Brightwell and Ramming. So far they move the ball with the effectiveness they need to get the clock stopped. Juggled ball once again. Boy, Bracey having a tough time squeezing the ball. It's the second time he's been put up the bat in the slot and just has not been able to reel it in.
Clock stops, 107 to go. Second and 10 for the Blue Devils, who led 10-7 and then 17-7 in the third quarter before the Panthers kicked a field goal in the third. TD and a field goal in the third quarter and the fourth quarter for Pittsburgh. This is going to be Bracey inside the 35.
And Tom, he did a really good thing at the end. He got knocked back, but he was able to get forward for the first down, which stops the clock. And really an early whine by the official. They hadn't set the chains yet.
Jones ramming. Made sure he got out of bounds inside the 30. Zeiss forced him out 4 yards.
Shock seeing a lot of man coverage. A little surprise leading by seven that Pitt's playing as much man coverage as they're playing.
I am as well. I thought they would. You saw there they tried to come after him and get the ball out of his hands quickly. But Daniel's making great decisions right now, getting the ball out of his hands and taking what the defense is giving him.
Second and 6 for Jones and the Blue Devils. Went through the progression, got the receiver, Helm. Out of bounds, clock will stop. 7 yards, first down, Duke.
And they're giving away the easiest throw. It's the short side out route. The slot receiver is just running an out, and they're running off the corner with a go route. That's the easiest throw to make if you're Daniel Jones.
Jones again over the middle, deflected, and picked off.
Boy, I thought
Jordan Whitehead.
Yeah, and I thought Helm got held on this play by Geist, the linebacker. Helm had been running the out route from the slot. This time he goes back inside, and it certainly looks like Helm wraps his arm, or that Geist wraps his arms around him. Let's take a look at this matchup right here in the slot. Wraps his arms around his waist, kind of changed his body a little bit. Ball got up high on him and tipped. Well, that's where you got to be careful when you got those safeties sitting in behind. A ball that's elevated is going to get tipped, and more often than not, it's going to get picked off. And it looks like Pitt is going to survive.
Whitehead with his first interception of the season off the deflection as Helm tried to pull it in. Duke was driving the football effectively, looking for the tying score.
Interception, first down, Pittsburgh.
Officials are getting together, but it's going to be a pick.
Certainly looked like his arms were underneath the ball, Tom, on the tip. The only question is Darrell Revis looks on, and Jordan Whitehead, a cousin of his, makes a play. Looked like a little play that you might see Revis Island make late in the game.
The Panthers are 45 seconds away from their first win in the ACC this season and first win on the road. They had been 0-3. Don't forget next Saturday, doubleheader, Louisville and Wake Forest. That's at noon. Duke, Virginia Tech, primetime, 7 p.m. Lane Stadium, Blacksburg, Virginia. Dave, myself, DJ, will all be there for that one.
Yeah, Pitt really did a good job of controlling the football, yet they didn't get much out of it until late. And give the star of the game, certainly our Chevy performance went to Darrin Hall, and rightly so. But give an assist to that big offensive line. Really did a nice job of sorting out some of the pressures Duke was coming with and created some creases in there. And another frustrating loss for Daniel Jones and Duke, but a big win for Pitt on the road.
Blue Devils are out of timeouts with 42 seconds showing on the clock. What a day for Hall as Danucci will take a knee. 254 yards rushing, three TDs. Darrin Hall had TD runs of 79 and 92 yards, added a four-yarder in the fourth quarter. And Pittsburgh comes back and they will get the win. A couple of fourth quarter scores. They had a touchdown from Hall and a 45-yard field goal from Kessman. And that is going to be the final score as the last seconds will tick off the clock here at Wallace Wade Stadium. 24-17, the final on the win for Pittsburgh. For highlights and must-see moments from this game and others, visit theacc.com. Coming up next on theacc.com, our studio crew, Katie, Tommy, Stan. More analysis of today's ACC action on our post-game show, Victory Formation, on theacc.com. Don't forget to join us next Saturday for two games, as we showed you. ACC Blitz, powered by Ram Trucks, gets us started at noon, followed by the Mellow Mushroom Game of the Week, Louisville at Wake Forest, but we've got two for you. Then at 7 Eastern, Dave, DJ, and myself are in Blacksburg. Duke takes on number 14, Virginia Tech. You've been watching coverage of Atlantic Coast Conference football on the ACC Network, an exclusive production of Raycom Sports. Pittsburgh wins it over Duke. Their first win in ACC play this season. We bid you a good afternoon from Durham, North Carolina.